Good morning, everyone. I'm thoroughly pleased to witness you all here in this workshop on practical aspects of IPR laws. It's my privilege to address you all on the behalf of Placement Assistant Counsel, Campus Law Center. I wholeheartedly welcome our professor in charge, Professor Dr. Alka Chawla ma'am, our teacher convener, Dr. Ruchita Chakrabarti ma'am, and all the esteemed speakers and associates from Singh Singh Law Firm. So we all have gathered here today to attend this workshop on practical aspects of IPR laws, wherein our speakers will be giving the insights of the practical world of IPR litigation. I hereby request Professor Dr. Alka Chawla ma'am to please present the welcome address. And we also thank ma'am to come here and bless us for this workshop. Thank you so much, ma'am, for coming out of your busy schedule. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Mayank. I hope you will all excuse me. I'm also down with fever, but I thought that I must come and speak. Very, very good morning to all of you. I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all the esteemed guest speakers from Singh & Singh Law Firm, Ms. Bitika Sharma, Ms. Mohit Vadva, Ms. Shifa Nagar, and Mr. Love Virmani. Thank you, Bitika. Whenever we've asked you to come to law faculty, you're always there, like a good alumni of the Faculty of Law. Thank you so much. We are so very grateful to you. And I hope that after our workshop, some more people will join from CLC in this great firm. I would also like to welcome all my colleagues at Campus Law Center and our dear students who've joined us today for this workshop on practical aspects of the IPR laws. I teach IPR, but at many times I feel handicapped because I do not have the practical knowledge as all of you have it. So I think students are going to have a double benefit, one of theory and the other of practical from all of you. I really appreciate your presence and sincerely hope that you all are keeping safe and doing well in these rather uncertain times. And in fact, I was told just now that Mr. Mohit Vadva, if I'm not wrong, is also down with fever. So Vrinda is going to speak. I wish him also a very speedy recovery. We all know that we live in a world that is constantly evolving in many ways. Maybe a decade or two ago, no one would have fathomed that we would be conducting such workshops remotely from our homes, or that our reality would resemble a science fiction movie. These fast-paced and at times unprecedented developments churn out new markets, fostering creativity and innovation. However, these changes come with their own set of challenges, and the protection of intellectual property rights is one of them. IPR infringements, if not prevented, they have the potential to smother the spirit of innovation and creativity, thereby adversely impacting the overall economy. Industries across India suffer massive losses due to counterfeiting. That is why IPR laws stand guard against these transgressions. In fact, there are so many reports which say that it is the easy earned counterfeiting money which is going towards terrorist activities. So one from the angle of IPR laws, second from the angle of industry, and third from the angle of defense, we need to very efficiently implement the IPR laws and stop counterfeiting. Now, if you consider the current scenario as disruptive and brutal this pandemic has been, it has also opened a floodgate of opportunities in the field of IPR laws. As the old adage goes, every cloud has a silver lining. The post-COVID world has also cast a positive influence on various sectors such as edtech, fintech, medical, biotech industries. The boredom and the monotony inflicted by this pandemic has also increased people's appetite for pop culture, leading to more and more creativity and content creation in the world of entertainment. Not only entertainment outside, even within the home, a lot of entertaining activities are coming up. In fact, people are inventing so many different kinds of games, getting into cooking, getting into new recipes, new designing, so many things are happening. However, these positive developments, they have simultaneously given rise to rampant infringement and counterfeiting also, as I said just a minute ago, which is where IPR laws come to our response, and the knowledge of the law and its practicality becomes indispensable. As they say, it is better to fail in originality than to succeed in imitation, which may not be the case as far as our country and some of the other countries go, but that is what we should basically look forward to. In that spirit, we are very excited in conducting this workshop in collaboration with leading practitioners in the field of IP. Today's sessions will give our students a real and a practical insight into various aspects of IP law, which is as important, if not more, than getting a theoretical understanding in the classroom. I would request all the students to very attentively listen to all of them. And in fact, after every session or howsoever the speakers feel comfortable, you should interact with them, because asking questions, and never think, sometimes students don't ask questions because they think that they're asking a wrong question or they may be asking a stupid question. But let me tell you, no questions are ever wrong. No questions are ever stupid. You should always be interacting and you should try to get the maximum from the speakers here. This is something which we cannot offer to you. So they have come all the way on your computers, in your homes, with the entire knowledge on the plate where you don't have to move anywhere. So please take care of the efforts that they have taken. As I said before also, Bitika, we proudly welcome you. Shifa, you also. The other speakers too, Love and Vrinda now are coming. But Bitika and Shifa specifically said because they are from our law faculty. And you know, that soft corner, you cannot take away from us. Let me take this opportunity to extend a warm virtual welcome once again and hope that both our students and our speakers will enjoy the interactive sessions today. I would have actually loved to be with you throughout the workshop. But because of some pressing responsibilities, one because of my health and secondly some interviews are going on in the faculty, I have to be there, so I would leave. But thank you all and God bless you all. I hope the workshop will give a lot of benefit to our students. Thanks, Vrinda, once again. Thank you so much. God bless you all.
Thank you, Alka ma'am, for your inspiring words. Now, let's begin with a session one for the day. I wholeheartedly welcome Vrinda Pathak ma'am, who is an associate at Singh Singh Law Firm LLP. Ma'am graduated from National Law University, Odisha in 2017, and she has been working as an associate with Singh Singh Law Firm since 2018. She handles both prosecution and litigation for trademarks and copyrights, and ma'am is also working for the litigation team for patent matters. Thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us.
Thanks a lot, Mayank, and good morning, everybody. My name is Vrinda Pathak, and I am an associate at Singh Singh Law Firm. Today, I've been asked to address the topic of trademarks and trademark prosecution. And as you may see from the pamphlet, Mr. Mohit Madhwa, the associate partner, was supposed to speak today, but he's down with COVID. So you can see that I have very large shoes to fill. Since I'm only a 2017 graduate, I would just request that this interaction, if it can be more of a conversation, I would just request you all to, if at any point you feel like adding something to what I'm saying or asking a question, you're most welcome to do that at any point. I also have with me Mr. Vikram Singh Dalal, who is a colleague of mine, who is helping me today. I would just request him to share the slides so that I can begin the session. Thanks a lot, Vikram. Could you just show the first slide? Right. So the first slide is, what is the meaning of a trademark? A trademark, if you look at the dictionary meaning of a trademark simply signifies a logo or a symbol that you attach to your products and services in order to acquire some distinction or distinctiveness. Now, you may think that if the whole purpose is to just get some distinction and not the quality of the product, why would trademarks law be such a nuanced field in IPR laws? The reason for that is that trademarks actually are inherently linked to the quality of the services that you provide. Because in order to, for example, Tata is a trademark. Now, you know, if you look at something which contains the trademark or logo Tata or McDonald's, you would know that there is a certain quality which is attached to that product that they are providing or the service they're providing. And also that they have the years of experience of providing these services par excellence. So this is the reason why we have trademarks law. The definition of trademarks law is, the term is defined in the act itself. It's provided in 2M. And a trademark is a distinctive mark capable of being represented graphically. Now, graphical representation is also a very important part of how a trademark is actually obtained and registered. We'll come to that a little later. And which is, now this part is what I was trying to emphasize, which is capable of distinguishing the goods of one person from that of the other. So this becomes very important because in the modern day and age, we have a lot, we are flooded with a lot of products and services, a lot of advertisements, a lot of people who are out there to sell us something. So in order to know what is good and what is not, we need to have some identification. So when you look at McDonald's, you know the source, you know where it is coming from. So now at the outset, I would just like to tell you all that in order to protect your rights under trademark, there is no obligation for you to get it registered. In some other fields of IPR, for example, in patents, etc., you need to, in order to have the right, you need to have a registration. In trademarks, it is not mandatory. So you can have, you can get a registration and you can also assert your rights without a registration based solely on the fact that you have been serving customers. You have been there in the market. So one thing about getting registration as opposed to not getting registration is the difference between filing a case for infringement as opposed to filing a case for passing off. So the other category wherein you don't get something registered is called passing off. And the difference between the two, now you may think that a registration process is a cumbersome process. It takes a lot of money. You need to have lawyers involved in order to, and you have to go through a whole procedure that I will explain later. But if it is not a mandatory requirement, then why do it at all? The reason is that there is a difference in how courts approach your case if it's a case of infringement, as opposed to if it's a case of passing off. Now, for example, you have a registration for some marks, for example, McDonald's, and you have instituted a case for infringement. What will happen is the courts, as has been guided by judicial precedents, they just have to look at the mark that you have registered, to look at the mark which is potentially offending. And they have to look at both these marks from the perspective of a person of ordinary intelligence. Now, ordinary intelligence is because a person who goes to buy stuff from the market is not supposed to be a genius. He's not supposed to remember and recollect each and everything that he looks at. So somebody with ordinary intelligence, if they look at both the marks, what is the impression that they will get? This is the inquiry for infringement. But for passing off, the inquiry becomes that something other than the mark can also play a very important role. For example, the trade dress, for example, McDonald's in yellow packaging as opposed to McDonald's in black packaging can be an indicator for you to know that this black packaging comes from person B. This is not a requirement in infringement. So if you want to safeguard your rights in order to just looking at the mark and not looking at the other circumstances, it is important for you to get a registration. That is why people go through the whole procedure of involving lawyers and spending money and, you know, all of that to get a registration. For passing off, for example, another thing would be that, you know, in for example, if you're selling biscuits and one biscuit is priced moderately, the other one is priced really high. So you would know that there is a difference in the customer base. So things like customer base, things like trade dress, etc., play a very dominant role in passing off, but not so much in infringement. So there is an option of getting your mark registered as opposed to not getting it registered, but it is always advisable to get the mark registered in order to have a more stronger statutory protection. Further, now if we look at the second point, there is a Controller General of Patent Design and Trademarks who is responsible for granting trademark registrations to proprietors. Now, I would just also like to make a contrast between what are the rights that are given by these people. For example, if we look at patents, there is a judicially created doctrine that a validity of a patent, if a patent is granted, that's not a proof of its validity. However, in trademarks law, there is a codified section, section 31 of the Trademarks Act, which says that if you have a registration, that is a prima facie proof of the validity of the mark, which means, number one, that your rights are more secured if you have a registration. And number two, there is a higher burden on these government bodies and departments to see and to decipher which mark actually deserves registration and which mark does not. So the area that I'm going to focus on is how to actually get a registration. Now, if anybody has any questions so far or anything to add.
Hi, ma'am. So could you please just briefly about the passing off concept?
Right. So like I said, there are two types of infringement cases that you can file. This is after you get a registration or don't get a registration. Passing off suit can be filed if you simply have your rights based on the use of the mark, based on the fact that you have been there in the market and you have been selling products par excellence. For example, I have a McDonald's trademark, which I did not get. I never got it registered. I never filed an application. I never went to the government department to do anything. But I've been in the market for the last, say, 20 years. Everybody knows who I am. And I've been providing services. I've been providing food, which is par excellence. So if I see a potentially infringing mark, if I see something which is very reminiscent to the McDonald's symbol, I can institute an infringement action. This is what I was trying to say. Without a registration, I can institute an action and I can be successful also. The only thing would be that the requirement for me to prove my reputation would be slightly higher as compared to infringement actions. So that is why it is always advisable to get your mark registered. However, it is not mandatory.
I want to ask something.
Yeah, sure.
Actually, I didn't get the drawbacks of not getting registered.
Right. I'll take that question. The drawbacks would be that in order to tell the court that your mark, see, because if you get a mark registered, it comes with certain sanctity. That somebody has seen all the papers, somebody has seen all of your use and your exposure to the customers, etc., and then granted you a registration. However, in case of passing off, nobody knows what your use is. If you go to the court has no papers to see, right? So you will have to show your goodwill. You will have to show your reputation from the scratch. So you can still do it in case of passing off. The drawback would just be that the onus on you would be very, very high.
All right.
So coming to the third point is that firstly, you have to get your trademark, you have to obtain some rights and get your trademark registered. And secondly, comes the protection stage where you can take an action against other people, which is the litigation part. So another good example of why you should get things registered is that then it becomes easier for you to document whether you are giving licenses to somebody, whether like whatever you are doing after the process of registration, because registration is like, it's like a certificate that you are the proprietor of this mark. Next slide, please, Vikram. Thanks a lot. This actually answers your question well. Why should you register trademarks? Because it prevents other people from using advertising, etc. The same thing would go for passing off as well. However, for passing off, you will have to, like I said, the onus would be a lot more. Then it's easier to license a sign, like I said already. Allows the remedy for infringement as a statutory remedy, right? So infringement is more of a statutory right and gives you a statutory remedy, because all of the actions that you can take in court is already codified in the law itself, in the statute itself. However, since passing off is a common law right, it's not really codified. So that also becomes a sort of a problem, that how will you go about proving the goodwill to the court?
I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so you've emphasized Nike's logo as slavery. So how is that something you've done? I can't understand it. How is that slavery?
So actually, the examples that have been given here, these are just examples of potential infringement cases. So Diet Coke is actually Diet Joke. These can be used in, you'd see that the color combination used in these marks are very closely reminiscent to the actual mark. For example, McDowell's and the symbol used here, it's very reminiscent to McDonald's. So what I can do is I can actually sell burgers under this mark and try to pass off my goods as somebody else's. This is what the slide was trying to, Subway has become Someday, because there are very slight differences here that can actually confuse a customer.
I have not come across Someday or McDonald's.
No,
are actual companies or like memes or something in there?
Yes, yes. Not memes per se. I cannot recollect an example of a meme, but it happens very often that, you know, some of the letters are actually interchanged so that people with imperfect recollection would just look at the color of the packaging, etc., and just buy something which is not coming from the authentic source. And that is why a lot of infringement actions are undertaken.
Okay, now
Thank you. There's another question from Avantika, I think.
Ma'am, how is this not an infringement case of design if it is basically like resembling their logo?
So design law is also an aspect of intellectual property laws, but designs are more to do with a aesthetic feature of something. For example, and not its functional quality and not its significance to the source. So if you want to signify where the source is coming from, that is called trademarks. If you want to signify that some, for example, a bottle has a very aesthetic design, which kind of differentiates it from the other bottles that are there in the market, that would mean a feature of a design. So this also might look as a design to you, but this is actually called a device. A device meaning a picture. Right. So if you want to institute a design action, and there is law which says that you cannot simultaneously get trademarks and a design registration. You can't have both. If you want to say that you're trying to signify the source of something to yourself, that would mean a trademark. And if you're trying to say that there is an aesthetic appeal, it's something beautiful and it's something different from the others, you would say that there's a design registration. Is there any other question?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I have a very general question. And I can see the illustrations on screen, Someday or Diet Joke, I believe they are made with a very satirical approach. They are not infringing on somebody's mark. So my question is, can making a joke or making a meme as such, can this also result in an infringement?
Yes. So if you look at it only from the trademark aspect, if you're making a joke or if you're trying to actually ride on somebody else's reputation, that becomes an irrelevant thing, right? So long as, for example, if your mark, let us take the example of Someday itself. If I'm taken to court, for example, if I'm selling Someday and I'm taken to court by Subway, and I can show to the court that this was just a joke, and it will be taken by the people, by the consumers, to be a joke, I will succeed in the action, which is to say that this will not amount to infringement. But if I can say that if the plaintiff is successful in proving that I am in some way trying to encroach on his market, I am trying to take away the customers, that would mean that this is infringement. So as I was saying, the question that you have asked, the case that immediately comes to my mind is regarding copyright law. So what I remember is that a US case where, so copyright protection you get over something that you've written, something that you have drawn or sketched, etc. there was a song, Oh Pretty Woman, which was made by a rapper, and it was then created into a parody. This happened in US and Second Circuit. So what happened was the defendant in that case was able to convey to the court that what I have made is just a joke. And whoever, so the lyrics of the song were, "Oh, pretty woman," etc., etc., telling you that the girl that he is in love with is really beautiful. So the parody which was made was, "Oh, hairy woman." So he was trying to say that this woman is not actually very beautiful. So when this case was taken to court, it's a very well-known case if you want to read it. It's called Ackerfrost case. In this case, what happened was that the defendant was successfully able to prove to the court that what I have done is a joke. If you don't allow me to take the lyrics from there and, you know, modify it, I will not be able to make this joke. So what I have done is I have taken a material and I have transformed it into something else, which would be different from saying that I'm encroaching on your market, or I'm taking your market share, or I'm trying to ride on your reputation, or I'm trying to make money from the song that you have made. So this is the difference between, because this question was very relevant in case of copyright law as opposed to trademarks. So this Ackerfrost case you might read.
Maybe the thing couldn't be termed as defamation towards Nike.
So I was trying to say that with respect to this particular mark, there can be a defamation case as well. And this is a very well thought of point, I must say, because in the other, if you look at the other examples, the joke is not to the extent of, you know, something morally derogatory. So if you want to, if you can establish that this slavery mark has, you know, it can give an impression to people that it actually emanated from Nike, and secondly, that it's trying to say something morally corrupt, there is definitely a chance of a defamation case as well. So I'll just skip to the next slide now. So now I wanted to tell you a little bit about what kind of marks can be there. So firstly, you can just have a trademark for a product that you're selling. For example, a biscuit, you know, Good Day, right? Secondly, you can also have a trademark for the services. Services would include, take for example, hotel services. So Bharat Hotels or Hotel Taj, all of these are also marks. There is no tangible product, but the services that they are providing are also something that can show distinctiveness and be a mark of quality. So that is also a kind of mark. A collective mark shows the organization which to which the mark belongs. For example, let's take the example of Air India. Now, Air India as a collective, you know that this is a flight service. You can have your opinion about whether, you know, they fly on time or not, whether it's a good company or not. But this Air India as a collective, like a group of people, have this mark registered. So this is a collective mark, which shows that the purpose is to indicate the goods or services of an association of traders rather than one person. Right. And a certification mark goes on to show the quality of the services. For example, you can say that the gold that you're using, it has an ISI mark or a BMI. So these kind of marks are actually, it goes on to show the quality of the goods and services. So we'll just skip to the next slide. Yeah, so this is interesting because the definition of the trademarks law says that you can, if you want to have a mark registered, there needs to be a graphical representation of the same. Now, so till now, till very recently, in fact, the marks that we used to get registered were only word marks and photographs. Like I said, they are called device marks or logo marks, etc. But now these are actually now called unconventional marks, because these marks relate to something that were not like trademarked before. So for example, Yahoo is one sound mark that has been applied and registered. MGM's Lion Roar. You can take the example of Nokia's Tune, which was made by A.R. Rahman. All these things have become so, they have acquired distinctiveness because of their years of use. If you listen to these sounds, you would know that this comes from, you know, this company or this person, which is the fundamental, which is a tenet on which trademarks law is based. And that is why unconventional trademarks are also now getting registered. So now next slide, please. Yeah, so in the process of getting a registration, you have to first satisfy the government authority that I spoke about earlier, that your mark is actually something that requires, has acquired some distinction. And that is why you're asking for a trademark registration. So there are two sections in the trademarks law which tell you about what are the grounds on which trademarks should be avoided registration. And these are essentially the sections on which the government authority, the examiners, look at while judging whether your mark should proceed to registration or not. So first is section 9, which says that marks that are not morally sound, or marks which are generic, or marks which are descriptive, etc., should not be given a registration. So if I take an example of a descriptive mark, say, for example, if I call a soap, like I call it a soap, and I say that this is my trademark, and I'm going to sell a soap, like with the trademark that it's a soap. So that will not qualify for registration. So this is a section 9 objection. And there is also a section 11 objection. Now, the difference between a section 9 objection and a section 11 objection is that while looking at section 9 objections, you just have to look at the mark itself and not compare it to anything else. If you see a soap by the name a soap, you know that this is nothing which requires a distinction. It does not require any right, right? So this is wrong and it will not get a trademark protection. As opposed to this, under section 11, you have to compare the mark with the already existing marks, because the problem occurs when one person has already told the market that this emanates from me, and you come up with a mark which is very similar to the already registered one. So the examiners, what they do is they look at their register. It's called a register of trademarks. It has all the marks registered, pending, abandoned, etc. And then they try to look for marks which are similar to the one that you have applied for. So this slide actually relates to non-registrable marks. So marks which are devoid of any distinctive character, etc., will not get a trademark protection. So sugar-free, very interestingly, is a case that we had worked on, our firm had worked on. And so what happens is sugar-free was denied registration, and that is why a passing of suit was instituted. So you can now see the distinction between an infringement case and a passing of case. So sugar-free, although it had years and years of experience, there was no absolute right which was given to sugar-free. The most that was given was that they can have a right in the class that they have applied registration, they are working in. So sugar-free could be one example of a very descriptive mark which was denied registration. And when we look at the types of marks, I would tell you something about the spectrum of distinctiveness and how you get rights on the kind of mark that you have applied on. So the kind of marks that I was talking about, one can be a descriptive mark. The example that I gave was calling a soap. That would be descriptive. A generic mark would mean that to a large amount of people, the mark has become reminiscent to one thing only. For example, the example that's given here is Xerox. Now, Xerox as such doesn't mean anything, and it's not a descriptive word. But when you look at, when you hear of the word Xerox, you know immediately what it means. So another party cannot get Xerox registered. And so the law is that a generic and a descriptive mark cannot get any registration. However, a suggestive mark is one where you are giving a suggestion that this could mean this thing, but it's not very clear. So for example, I'm not calling a soap, but I'm calling it a cleaning agent. So by cleaning agent, there is a suggestion that it could be something to do with, you know, soap, but it could be n number of other things. So that would be a suggestive mark. So the law says that a generic mark and a descriptive mark, these are not registrable, but a suggestive mark is registrable. The next slide would show you marks that have a higher in the spectrum of registration. In the spectrum of distinctiveness, there are some marks that acquire a higher standard. For example, an invented or fanciful mark. An invented and fanciful mark means a mark which has no meaning. So for example, Kodak is not a dictionary word. It doesn't mean anything. But now if you listen to Kodak, you automatically you know what it means. So this is the acquired distinction of the highest level, right? Just below that, you have an arbitrary trademark. An arbitrary trademark means a mark which has a dictionary meaning, but you're not using it for the product that you're using it for. For example, Apple. Apple is a dictionary word, you know what it means, but I'm not using Apple trademark to sell apples. I'm using the trademark to sell laptops and phones. So that is slightly down, but is also registrable. So in the spectrum of distinctiveness, the first thing is the fanciful marks, which has the highest level of distinctiveness and registration. Second is arbitrary, then suggestive, then descriptive, and then generic. So generic and descriptive marks are not registrable at all. Suggestive, fanciful, and arbitrary marks are in fact registrable. So the next slide says who all can file for a registration. It can be an individual, it can be a firm, it can be a body corporate, trust society. Hindu undivided family can also file for a registration of a trademark. Then next. Okay, so this is slightly technical. This is the registration process. So like I said, the first thing is to get your mark registered. And the next thing is to find out people who can be potentially infringing your mark and taking them to court. So this process of registration does not actually happen in court. This goes to the government authority that I was talking about earlier. So when you file for a trademark, you have to first see this register of trademark that I was talking about. It's actually a public document. You can look at all the trademarks that can potentially be held to be, you know, registered before you. And based on that, you can take a call on whether you want to get this mark registered or not. Then when you are sure that, you know, your mark actually is distinctive enough to acquire a trademark protection, you file for the trademark application, which is the second thing in this chart. Then once you file for the application, you are allotted with an application number, right? That becomes the distinctive application number, which stays with you throughout, even after registration. The next step is that your application is examined by the examiner, and then he can take a call on whether, you know, the mark is good enough to directly accept it or to object it. If the examiner thinks, and most often all marks are objected, there are very few category of marks which are directly accepted. So for the objected marks, the examiner comes up with an examination report wherein they can take either Section 9 objection or Section 11 objection. Section 9 objection is an objection taken based on the mark itself, and Section 11 is contrasting it with the already registered pending mark. So once the examination report comes out, you have 1 month's time to reply to that. You can actually in writing convince the examiner to accept the mark because of such and such reasons. You can say that my mark is distinct because you can show the number of years of, you know, your being in the market, all the acquired distinctiveness because of your work that you have done. All of that goes into a reply, as a reply to the examination report. Once the examination report and the replies are in place, you are called for a hearing. It's called a show cause hearing. If you look at the right hand side of this chart, in the show cause hearing, you are asked to explain the grounds as to why your mark should be accepted. If the controller is not, if the examiner is not satisfied with the explanation that you're giving, your mark is refused, right? And if they are satisfied with the explanation that you've given, your mark moves to acceptance stage. Now, after acceptance, now this is only the examination that happens between you and the examiner. Now, the next stage, once your mark is accepted, there is a requirement on part of the examiner to publish this application. So it becomes open for everyone to oppose. Now, every interested person can actually see that, oh, the examiner missed this mark, but my mark is very similar to this mark. So they have a 4 month period after the publication to lodge a notice of opposition. They can file an opposition, right? So in case in the 4 months, there is no third party, no member of the public that thinks that your mark is conflicting with their mark, the mark actually automatically moves to registration. However, if the third party or any interested person thinks that your mark is potentially conflicting with their already registered mark or their already pending mark, they can file a notice of opposition. Now, when a notice of opposition is filed, there is a procedure. 2 months are given to you to file a counter to that, and then the evidence, and then there is another hearing. So the registration process, I would say, can be divided into two parts. First is the examination that happens at the stage of the examiner, which only requires the examiner and the registered marks and you. And once you're through with that stage, there is another stage where the public is made to file any opposition if they think that there is any conflict. So if there is any question regarding this chart.
I have a very basic question, like the deadlines mentioned in this chart, are they very strict? Like suppose if I do not comply with this, my trademark gets altogether rejected, or can I file a continuation of delay?
Right, that's a very good question, because in other fields, there is always an exception that you can file for extensions. However, in trademarks prosecution, that is just not possible. Sometimes what happens is that if you have lapsed on a deadline, you are sometimes called for a show cause hearing, depending on whether the examiner thinks that you could be given a chance. If on that show cause hearing you can convince the examiner, then otherwise these deadlines are very, very strict. If you lose your chance, you lose it completely. There is nothing that you can file after that. You can just appeal that order and you can explain, but there is no such process of condonation is not really there.
All right, ma'am, thank you so much. Ma'am, I have another very basic, like a different question regarding unconventional trademarks.
Yeah.
As per the mandate of the Trademark Act, a trademark must be capable of being represented graphically. Yes. But like, how do we represent a sound mark, or for that matter, a smell mark graphically? So like, additionally, are there any examples of a smell mark registered in India?
Example of a smell mark, I can't think of a smell mark as such. But earlier you were talking about the sound marks. The notations, etc. are something that you can graphically show. So that is what you show to the registrar. So your application will actually have the notes that you have made in order to, for example, the Nokia tune. So this graphical representation part is actually the problem, that a lot of trademarks are not being able to get registered like that. So I think that's a very good observation on your part when you say that the definition itself says that it should be able to get graphical representation. That is the reason, you know, these things are called non-conventional marks as such.
Ma'am, Aditya this side, just following it to what my friend said, especially in the light of change in European Union's trademark law, they eliminated the requirement of graphical representation because of tremendous demand for registration of non-conventional trademark, especially like 3D and all of that. Could you give some sort of understanding why the legislature in India is not doing it, especially when internationally it has happened already?
Okay, why they are not doing it? This is a slightly tricky question, but I think this is my personal opinion, of course. I think that with respect to non-conventional trademarks, we are still at a very, you know, I would say at a very nascent stage. A lot of, it's not as if, you know, 100 or like 1,000 applications have been filed and we do not have the law. So the legislature is pressed to do something. Like if we give you an example of non-conventional trademarks, like the examples that come to my mind are barely like 5, 6, 10, 15, you know. So one of the reasons could be that people are not really very inclined at this stage to get these trademarks registered. This is my thinking as to why legislature has not yet done anything, but like still a very good question, I must say.
Thank you.
Yeah. So I'll just move to the next slide. Thank you so much, Vikram. So like I earlier said, there can be goods that you can affix your trademarks to, and there can also be services. So services, like I gave an example of hotel services or like, you know, a theme park or something, you can have, for example, IT services, etc. You can have services marks as well. So the total number of classes are 45. And I think I've not mentioned this earlier. A class differentiation means that particular group of products or services, what they comport with, are placed in one class. For example, like software, etc., are placed in class 41. For example, stationery, etc., is placed in class 16. So if your mark is, I am selling some pens, etc., under a trademark, Now, in order to file an application, I'll have to tell the examiner what the mark, what the class under which I'm trying to apply. So I'll have to choose between 1 to 45 marks, and my protection would be limited to these goods only. For example, if I have applied for XYZ trademark for pens under class 16, so when I go to court to assert my right, I'll be able to assert it only with respect to class 16 goods. Now, the exception to that is that I become a well-known trademark. A well-known trademark, also defined under the Act, means that I have attained so much distinction. Like when I say Tata, you know who I am, right? So Tata can be for, you know, one kind, for example, Reliance. So Reliance was earlier doing only one kind of business. Now they are everywhere. So they are providing you SIMs. They are providing you, there's a Reliance Fresh for, you know, fruits, etc. There is a Reliance clothing brand also. So you know that once a brand has reached that height, that kind of acquired distinctiveness, they are so well known that if an infringer comes in class 16 and Reliance is not in class 16, Reliance would be able to stop that person only because it's a well-known trademark. So I hope I was clear with that part. Is there any question regarding that?
Ma'am, can you not register within two classes or more than one classes?
You can do it separately as well. Like you can have two applications, one for, you know, class one and class two, or you can have, there is a provision of filing a multi-class application. So you can, you know, in one application itself, you can say that I want registration for class 17, 16, etc., etc. But your rights, you have to remember, would be limited to those classes only. So like practically speaking, people who want more protection would want that the classes are more, right? And in the description of classes, so this is also very important, when you file an application, you have to not only say that you're applying in a certain class, you also have to mention the goods for what you're applying. So a little, like, you can get some guidelines from the NIS classification, which is an accepted classification, wherein you can see that in class 16, like I just told you stationery, but in stationery also there can be like 100 things for which I would want protection. So I can take some guidance from those classification and I can say that these are the goods and services. These 25 words that I've written here, I want protection on all of them. So if the examiner thinks, now the good thing and the bad thing related to this is that I can want, if I am a big company and I want to stop a lot of infringers, I would want to acquire as large a protection as I can, right? So the bad thing which comes with it is that when you have a protection which is that big, you know, other people can say that you are conflicting with their mark. So like practically speaking, the bigger companies usually go with trademark protection which is large, like a lot of goods description. However, the smaller companies try to keep their description very narrow, so as to not conflict with, you know, the bigger entities. Any question?
There already exists a prior user and now the well-known mark has expanded to their class. How will their rights be decided?
Right. So this is a very good question, I think. So prior user in a normal situation where the other mark is not a well-known mark, the prior user will have higher ground, and I would say that there is a higher likelihood that a prior user would win the challenge, right? So even for a registered mark as opposed to an unregistered mark which is prior use, prior user will always trump. But the example that you have given, the other mark is actually a well-known trademark. In this case, at least in my opinion, I think the well-known trademark has a higher chance of succeeding. Because a well-known trademark is not in this class particularly, but they have acquired distinctiveness from a lot of other uses. So I think in this particular situation, a well-known trademark has more chances of success.
Ma'am, I had a question similar to that, and it also involves the concept of passing off. Like you mentioned that it would be decided based on the goodwill and reputation of a certain company or a firm. So my question is that reputation could mean reputation in a locality for some people. For some people, it could mean in the entire country.
And for some yes. people, it would mean the entire world. So how are we supposed to draw a line when it involves goodwill and reputation of a certain firm?
Right. So this is a very good question. I think the reputation and goodwill that you have to show depends on what class that you have applied for and what is the customer base. For example, if I am selling pens only, so I would say that my customer base would be, you know, people who are students or people who are going to office, etc. So in this customer base, how many people know me? Like, do they know if I'm doing well? Are they buying my products? Do they look at the advertisements that I'm putting out? And these kind of things, this goodwill and reputation, which is, you know, a term, it's very, like, it's an often used term. What we have to essentially show is, you know, the kind of the number of invoices, my turnover, you know, how many people are buying from me, right? So it can mean a locality or it can mean India also. I wouldn't say outside India because that's like a trans-border thing, which like I'm not discussing right now. But if I can show that, you know, everybody in India knows the pen that I'm selling, it would be better. Like the more people know me, the more people associate the product with me, the merrier it is for me.
Right. Thank you so much.
Hello, ma'am. So with regard to the above mentioned prior user concept, first of all, I have just one suggestion that for everyone that you can refer the case, the battle between KSRTC and KSRTC of Kerala and Karnataka. My doubt is also with regard to the same topic, the judgment from the trademark registrar. So, ma'am, in that judgment, it actually allowed the Kerala State Road Transport to use the acronym KSRTC, despite the Karnataka State Road Transport has registered already registered and Kerala have not registered, but it has been using it since 1963. But during the same judgment, they were more relying towards the use of acronym along with the nickname, which Kerala has been using as an Anavandi, which means the vehicle of elephant. So I was just, I found it quite contradictory that whether our trademark law is allowing to use and such nicknames considering, and how would that be?
Okay, this is a very, very good question. I say that because there is a case that we had worked on, Singh and Singh, which concerned with acronyms, right? So there was an acronym called TCV, which was a short for typhoid conjugate vaccine, right? This is a specific kind of vaccine which is given to children aged 2 to 6, I think. And the conflicting mark, so we were for the defendants, our mark was Zydus TCV. So they said that they had a registration on the mark TCV and we were not registered. The case that I was talking about, it's actually a vaccination. The registration was on the mark TCV. We were the defendants, the conflicting mark, so to speak. And our mark was Zydus TCV. So the defense that we put forth was that TCV, now typhoid conjugate vaccine, is actually a very generic and descriptive term. But the fact that you have made it an acronym does not mean that you can have monopoly over that mark, right? So TCV, so the flight of imagination from TCV to typhoid conjugate vaccine is not that much. So the law regarding acronyms, which we had researched on at that time, was that if your acronym is such that, you know, if someone looks at the acronym, they can never tell what the actual meaning is, then you can get a registration over that. For example, the chicken company, KFC, you don't know if you have not, you know, you have not come across what it actually means. You don't know what it stands for, right? Because it has no connection with, you know, chicken as such, right? And H&M, for example. However, in that case, we were successful only because we said that from typhoid conjugate vaccine to TCV, there is not a lot of, you know, flight of imagination which is required. So the thing that you found odd, I think I agree with it, that, you know, you cannot just make an acronym from a descriptive term and get a trademark or protection on that. So is there anything else? I think I've answered your question. Is that Did that help?
Ma'am, is it
yes? Yes, ma'am. But
full form is not related to chicken. So, I think it's Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Yeah, yeah. But the Kentucky part will not like strike you as such. You know, if you don't know it, you wouldn't know what K stands for. So KFC per se, I would say, is some level of distinctiveness, and I think it, you know, merits a trademark protection, at least in my opinion.
Ma'am, with regard to the previous question, same. There is already one registered mark, and there is another mark which is prior user. So recently, I mean, after the registered mark has filed an infringement suit against this prior user, but the registrar of a trademark has allowed the prior user also to use it. So what would be the chance of this prior user to move against the registered user barring them to use it further?
With respect to registered mark as opposed to a prior user, I think a prior user has a very high chance of succeeding in trademark cases. There is a Supreme Court authority to that extent also. So if you are asking me whether, you know, in a battle between a registered mark opposed to a prior user, I think a prior user always has a higher chance of succeeding.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Any other question?
Ma'am, I do have a question. Just on the point of prior user, like what would be the threshold or the onus on prior user if it has to contest against a well-known trademark, ma'am? Is there a possibility, like as you have already said, the threshold would be high because you are not registered and the sense like the validity of the mark would be low, but is there still a chance to contest against a well-known trademark if you are a prior user?
Absolutely, there is a chance that you can actually show that you have not registered the mark, but your prior use is so strong that you can collide with a website. You can do that. I'm just saying that in my opinion, I think a well-known trademark has a higher chance of succeeding.
I have a question. Yep. Can it be registered for only one state, or it's registered for a whole in all over India?
Right. So the application that you have to file is to be in one regional office itself, but the protection that you get is not confined to a region, unless your examiner thinks that, you know, you are not worthy, your mark is not worthy of a trademark protection, if not for that region itself, right? So your protection would be all over India is what I'm trying to say, unless, you know, the examiner thinks otherwise.
Ma'am, I have a question that if any marks has been registered as a trade, as a word mark, then sometime, ma'am, such kinds of objections has been raised by the registry that your device mark is deceptive with any word mark. Whether if any word mark has been registered, that decline the other applicants to register the same as a device mark.
Okay, so you're saying that you have a word mark registered, but the other person has a device mark registered.
Yes.
Again, yes. I think this is a fantastic question. So in the sense, if you have your registration and your right and monopoly is only confined to the word mark, right? However, if somebody is using that same word for a device, this is a very good case for infringement. Now what the defendant can do is, because strictly speaking, your right is only qua the word that you have used. So if I'm the defendant and in the debate changes sufficient enough, you know, there are a lot of, like, the picture is so different that there cannot be any confusion as to whether, you know, the mark is emanating from you or me. Right? Because if you have a word mark registration, you do not have the right to use it in the picture that the defendant is using it in. Right? So the defendant has every right to show that the picture on which that word mark has been placed is so distinctive that there is no chances of confusion. So to answer your question, there cannot be like a strict thing as to whether, you know, you can go against a device mark or not. 100% you can do that. The defendant on the other side will just have to show that the device is different enough so that there will not be any confusion. Right?
Ma'am, there is any judgments on that part?
I think there is one Cadbury judgment from the Supreme Court that I can think of right now, but I do not remember the name of the case. I'm so sorry, you'll have to excuse me on that. But there are sufficient number of cases wherein, you know, a word mark asserted against a device mark, and some have been successful also. So there is no strict guidelines, I would say, But like I explained, the defendant will have to show how the mark is different, even though the word used is the same.
This device versus word mark.
Ma'am
would take versus it. IU, Calcutta High Court.
All right. Thank you so much. So I'll just quickly wrap up my session because I think I far exceeded my time and there are a lot of other speakers. So thank you so much. This was a very interactive session and I really liked talking to you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for the wonderful session. It was very engaging, very fruitful. Apologies, we could not cater to all the questions because, of course, we are running short on time. I would now like to welcome and introduce our next speaker for the next session, Ms. Shifa Nagar, for the session on trademark litigation. Ms. Nagar, she is a graduate from Campus Law Center, Faculty of Law, University of Delhi. She graduated in 2013. She's also done a bachelor's in English from Sri Venkateshwara College, University of Delhi. She's also procured a master's degree in international relations from Queen Mary University of London, United Kingdom. She's a generalist lawyer with over 7 years of experience in predominantly in civil litigation, arbitration, insurance law, and intellectual property law. She joined Singh and Singh LLP in 2021 January in the IP litigation team as a senior associate. And prior to Singh and Singh, she worked with Phoenix Legal for about 3 years and handled arbitration, insurance litigation, and advisory matter in courts all over India. She has also worked with Justice Manmohan, High Court of Delhi, as a legal researcher for about 2 years. Very much welcome, ma'am. Now you may take over.
Thank you. Thank you. I think Vrinda has already done a very good job of expressing and giving you an overview of everything related to trademarks. But unlike her, I would request all of you to please aim your questions at the end of the session. I will try to finish the session as quickly as possible so that you can ask as many questions as I am able to answer. Now, I would just, as a review, again, start with the Amna here will be helping me with the presentation. Amna, can you please put up the presentation? Right. So first, we'll start with, again, an overview on what is a trademark. As you would all know, that trademark is defined under Section 2ZB of the Trademarks Act as being capable of represented graphically and which is capable of distinguishing the goods and services of a person from those of others. It may include shapes of their goods, packaging, combination of colors, or even a color. This definition would take us to what is relevant in trademarks is their functions. With respect to trademarks, functions is a very important factor, which includes identification. Firstly, identification of products and services. This does not mean that it must inform the consumer of the actual person who has manufactured the product or even the one who's trading in it. It is sufficient that the consumer can trust the enterprise or the company manufacturing the product. For example, you will get extremely unhealthy yet satisfying product from a company which has the logo M in yellow and red background being McDonald's. And we would all trust that it would give us a kind of product which we are used to. Secondly, a trademark works as a source and quality identifier. A trademark works as a badge of origin. It should be able to distinguish the goods of the enterprise or the company from those of other enterprises. For example, here would be electric devices that we trust, the brands that we trust, Apple, Havels, Usha, Philips. All of these are the brands that we actually trust and go to. Thirdly, a trademark should be an advertisement for your product. It should be able to advertise a product or services anywhere that you see the trademark. It should be able to indicate that which enterprise the product or service it belongs to. Here, what I would like to talk about is a well-known trademark. Well-known trademark, according to the definition provided in the Act, can be called so when it has become so well-known to the substantial segment of the public through its extensive use, extensive and continuous use. While it may sound simple, before a court, the threshold for being determined a well-known trademark is quite high, as Vrinda also discussed. Some factors which will clarify this, the aspects of being determined as a well-known trademark would be that the proprietor or a person seeking to get his trademark determined as well-known should show that the mark is well-known in the public at large. For this, you have to show the court that the number of actual or potential consumers of the goods and services have to be given to the court and shown to the court with in any manner possible. You have to show the duration, extent, and geographical area of the use of such trademark. Only then can a trademark be determined as a well-known trademark. Here, the examples would include Bajaj, Benz, Bisleri, Whirlpool, KitKat, even Microsoft, Nestle, Havels. All of these are very familiar sounding names, and all of these have been determined as a well-known trademark by the registry or the High Court or the courts. Now, this has already also been discussed by Vrinda, the types of trademarks. In India, the most predominant types of trademarks are word and service marks. These are the trademarks which work as source identifiers of a particular product or service, such as, for example, FedEx. Service marks may include slogans. Also, for example, slogan Zindagi Ke Saath Bhi or Baat Bhi indicates the services of LIC, which is very well known to all of us. Secondly, there are shape marks. Distinctive shape of the product can also become a trademark. For example, the triangle of a Toblerone chocolate or the shape of the Coca-Cola bottle, which we are very well aware of. Logos and symbols such as Apple with the bite in it, the Nike logo with the check swish and the slogan, just do it. McDonald's and its red and yellow M. All of these logos and symbols are protected. The design component as well as the components with the words, the colors, all of these can be protected under the Trademarks Act. Collective marks are the kind of marks which are used by a body of people or an organization to identify themselves. For example, Cambridge University Press, Tata Sons, Reliance Communications, the company secretary's logo qualification. Then these are the, there may be enterprises, subsidiaries, persons performing maybe completely different functions, completely unrelated to each other, but they still indicate a standard of goods and services. Lastly, there's a certification marks, which as the name would suggest, are used to certify a standard of quality of services. For example, ISI, Woolmark, BIS, etc. For certification, the product or services has to be designated as such post tests or other requisite qualifications which need to be satisfied. Now, if I remember, Vrinda spoke in detail with respect to some unconventional trademarks, and I think a few of you were intrigued by registration of smell marks. In India, no smell marks have been registered due to the practical impediment of representing smell graphically, which is the requirement in the Trademarks Act. But in US and UK, smell marks have been registered. For example, the first smell mark was registered was a floral smell for rubber tires in the US. However, there haven't been many smell mark registrations as such because of the abstract nature of such marks. There is practical difficulty which arises in registering them and can cause a lot of issues and difficulties before the registry. Next topic that I would like to move on to is categories of protection of trademark. The two categories of protection under law are statutory law for infringement under the Trademarks Act and the common law remedy of passing off. The difference lies in whether your trademark is registered or not. If your trademark is registered, both remedies of infringement and passing off are available to you. However, if it is not, then the proprietor can claim passing off as its trademark. It's not left remedy-less. Firstly, infringement. Trademark infringement is defined under Section 29 of the Act. When any unauthorized person uses a trademark that is identical or deceptively similar to a trademark, to a registered trademark, it is known as infringement. In this regard, the important elements which need to be considered is firstly, unauthorized use by a person. When a trademark is used without authorization from a registered proprietor, there is no assignment deed or license deed which has been given, it constitutes infringement. And more importantly, the trademark, as I mentioned before, has to be registered with the trademarks registry in India. The trademark is either identical or deceptively similar to the mark. Deceptively similar, for example, include cases such as KitKat for KitKat, Abibas for Adidas. Basically, it would lead to likelihood of confusion in the customer base. And lastly, the goods and services of the infringer are the same. However, the exceptions are there in the Trademarks Act, which include use of the trademark in accordance with honest practices. This would be in industrial and commercial matters, which would include that there is no connection with each other. That would constitute as an honest practice. The use is not to take undue advantage detrimental to the distinctive character or reputation. The infringement is under the ambit of limitations. For example, sometimes when you register your trademark, the registry gives you certain kind of limitations that you cannot, if you're getting registered India Today or India TV, you don't have any right over the work India or TV separately, but together. If such there is such limitation, you cannot also, it's barred under the Trademarks Act to get India registered as a trademark. So if there are such limitations, you cannot enforce infringement. Lastly, infringed use of trademark is in the continuance of permitted use by the original proprietor. Then it does not constitute infringement. Next, we come to passing off. Just because a mark is not registered, it does not mean that it loses its value as an identifier, as a mark or a trademark of a person. If it performs all the functions, as I had mentioned before, it can be protected as a trademark under the principle of passing off. This fundamental principle of passing off has been determined or was determined by the English courts in the 1800s itself, which basically goes on to say that the man is not to sell his goods under the pretense that they are the goods of another person. Section 27(2) of the Trademarks Act provides for passing off, which states that nothing in this act shall be deemed to affect the rights of action against any person. Nothing in this act means the sections related to infringement. For passing off of goods or services as the goods of another person or as services provided by another person or the remedies in respect thereof. In this regard, I would like to mention the case of Cadila Healthcare versus Cadila Pharmaceuticals, which would clarify the meaning of passing off for you guys. The Supreme Court held that unfair trade competition by which a person through deception attempts to obtain economic benefit of a reputation which the other has established for himself. However, passing off does not have to be intentional. It can happen intentionally also. The basic aspect is that there should be misrepresentation leading to confusion in the public. To summarize, the differences between infringement and passing off are that infringement happens of registered trademark, while passing off can be taken with respect to unregistered trademarks only. There are statutory remedies for infringement, whereas passing off has common law remedies in it. In case of infringement, the owner can seek damages because those are provided for under the Act. In passing off, damages cannot be sought under the Act. However, if you can prove, practically speaking, the courts can give damages even in passing off cases. Proving ownership in case of infringement is easy, as you have a documentary proof that you have your trademark is registered. Ownership, the onus of proof in passing off is high. You will have to, it will have to be established through prior continuous use, and the claim would be based on facts and circumstances of each case. The remedies available are different, although both are protected under Section 29 of the Trademarks Act. Now we come to something that is not usually taught in our course books, which is pre-trial preparations. Now, before filing a suit or a claim before a court, we usually, in trademark matters, we usually go in for pre-trial preparations, which form an important part. We conduct thorough examination prior to filing of a suit. This includes appointment of an investigator, which conducts an investigation into several aspects to identify the source, the nature of infringement. He goes and buys the products, which would be included in the suit as proof. Then it would include the number of infringers. If they're third parties, then we have to actually go in and ascertain how many infringers there are. Sometimes the manufacturer and the seller are different, so we have to go in and investigate and make each and every one of them a party. The amount of infringing material, whether it's just something which is not relevant enough for us to file a suit for, and we can just send them a cease and desist notice. The commercial benefit earned by the infringer, the confusion caused among the general public out of such utilization or use. Once all of the above is determined, usually we send a cease and desist notice, which helps in cutting costs. Sometimes the infringer usually stops when we send the cease and desist notice. However, once we take a decision to file a suit, the plaintiff has to establish a strong case, his own case, and the case has to stand on its own feet, for which we have to show the prior adoption of the trademark as opposed to the infringer. Exhaustive and continuous use since its adoption. It should not be that the mark has been registered and the person has merely kept it in its pocket without actual use. Goodwill and acknowledgement that the trademark has attained recognition in the public. Unauthorized use by the defendant. Loss of goodwill and reputation of the plaintiff due to unauthorized use. When we are filing a case, we have to, in great detail, give all of these aspects to show the court that yes, there is an infringement and we require an injunction. Now, in remedies, the types of remedies that are available to in cases of infringement are both civil and criminal remedy. First, I will talk about civil remedies. Under Section 134 of the Trademarks Act, if there is an infringement or passing off, which has been proved, the civil remedies which can be provided by the court would predominantly be an injunction or stay order under against the impugned mark. If an application under Order 39, Rule 1 and 2 of the Civil Procedure Code for interim directions is made, the court may grant an interim ex parte injunction, in fact, which means that an infringer can be injuncted or stopped from using the mark without any representation in court. After that, and in addition to that, you can ask for appropriate damages, rendition of accounts of the infringer. We can ask for delivery up of the infringing goods and marks. We can ask for appointment of a local commissioner, which would go in and act as eyes and ears of the court and make a report on whether there is an actual infringement, he basically conducts an investigation on the part of the court. He's an officer of the court. And we can also ask for cost of the legal proceedings, which has been expended into filing the suit. In this regard, I would like to mention that we represented Nestle in this, we were successful in getting a decree passed for perpetual injunction restraining the defendant from using the trademark Nestle or any other mark which is identical or similar. In Bharat Biotech International Limited versus Optival Health Solutions before the Delhi High Court, I think Vrinda mentioned this case law as well. We obtained an order denying injunction to use the mark TCV, which is an abbreviation of typhoid conjugate vaccine. And the High Court has held that it's a generic name, which is open for generic use by anybody. In criminal remedies, the infringement of trademark under the Trademarks Act is a cognizable offense. It is codified under Chapter 12 of the Trademarks Act. You can go and file a complaint against infringer before the magistrate seeking orders for investigations under Section 156(3) of the Criminal Procedure Code. A direct complaint can also be filed before the police. And then the concerned DSP or ASP seeks opinion from the Registrar of Trademarks. After the report is received, the reliefs which can be granted can be imprisonment and fine up to 50,000 to 2 lakhs. Then the imprisonment for 6 months. And as the slide will show, Section 104 shall be punishable for every consecutive offense with imprisonment not less than 1 year and with a fine not less than 1 lakh rupees. While filing a suit, we have to be aware of the pecuniary jurisdiction. In 2015, the Commercial Courts Act was introduced and separate courts have been established called commercial courts for speedy resolution of commercial disputes. The commercial disputes has been defined under Section 21C of the Act, which includes all and any disputes arising out of intellectual property rights as well. Territorial jurisdiction, with respect to territorial jurisdiction, the plaintiff has 3 options where he can file a suit. Firstly, where the defendant actually and voluntarily resides or carries out business, where the cause of action wholly or partly arises, where the plaintiff actually resides or carries on business. Next, the stages of suit. The stage one includes we file a suit with application for a plaint with application for temporary injunction along with an application for seeking appointment of local commissioners. If the court is satisfied, then an ex parte interim injunction order can be granted on day one itself or notices issued in the suit. The basis of granting an ex parte injunction includes prima facie case, balance of convenience, and irreparable damage for which the plaintiff has to create a case in its favor a strong case in his favor, in fact. Stage two includes framing of issues and trial. The issues have to be agitated by both the parties and they're framed by the court. While framing issues, it has to be identified as to whom the onus of proof lies, the issue lies, and accordingly, evidence is led by both the parties and cross-examination of the parties is conducted. Stage three includes final arguments. The parties then finally have to argue their case on the basis of evidence led and the depositions recorded in the matter, pursuant to which the judgment is issued. Now, in a suit, there are several defenses which are also available to the defendant for infringement or passing off. As a defendant in the suit, there are the defenses which are available to justify the use include, firstly, fair use. The accused infringer, in order to take this defense, needs to establish that he has taken the consent of the authorized owner of the trademark, or either he proves that he doesn't have any intention to defraud or mislead the consumers of the goods. The defendant can also show prior use of the mark and has the prior use of the mark has more rights than the subsequent user, even if the subsequent user's mark is the registered one. Delays and lashes and acquiescence by the registered proprietor, then honest and concurrent use can be a solid defense if a person is able to show that it has adopted the mark honestly and about the same time without being aware of the plaintiff's mark. Section 12 of the Trademarks Act provides for this ground. Bona fide adoption or intention of adoption in relation to goods and services. There is also one interesting defense which can be raised is international exhaustion. Exhaustion means that if the trademark goods are once put in the market by the owner or by his consent and once purchased legitimately, the trademark owner or anyone deriving his title from him cannot prevent further sale of such goods. International exhaustion works on the assumption that the whole world is one market or one country is a market, and thus goods once sold in any part of such market or country operate as exhaustion of rights of the trademark owner over such goods. This would include, for instance, I buy a branded bag and I sell it forward, or I buy anything which I have the receipt for and has been legitimately legally bought by me and I sell it forward. Such activities or sales are allowed and they are included in the defense which can be taken. Then lastly, different class of goods, that is, if I'm using a trademark for instance, food item, and another person starts using the same one mark for bed sheets, you can't injunct the other person. It's very difficult to injunct the other person unless you prove a huge consumer base and goodwill and well-knownness of the mark. Otherwise, however, if the classes are similar or same, for instance, if I'm using it for selling a food item and another person has opened a restaurant in the same under the same trademark, then the restaurant owner or the subsequent user can be injuncted. And another interesting aspect is that damages can be sought in trademark cases, which include compensatory damages. That is, compensatory damages basically mean payment for all natural and direct consequences which have resulted in loss to the plaintiff from the acts of the defendant. Nominal damages include when injury is established, but no proof as such of damages can be adduced. So nominal damages for 50,000, 20,000, any small amount can be awarded by the court. Punitive damages are awarded when the court is convinced that the defendant's conduct has been willful and malicious and intentional and has resulted in grave consequences or loss to the plaintiff, then punitive damages are awarded in this regard. There are many cases where damages have been awarded by the courts, such as Time Incorporated versus Lokesh Srivastava and another. Punitive damages of 5 lakhs were awarded in Cartier International AG case. 1 crore damages were awarded. Exemplary damages can be awarded only if the court is satisfied that the punitive or exemplary element is not sufficiently met within the figure which they have arrived at for the plaintiff's solution. Now, I would like to discuss certain interesting cases which raise interesting issues of law in trademark matters. Firstly, I would like to discuss Toyota Jidosha Kabushki Kaisha versus Prius Auto Industries Limited case. In this case, the issue revolved around the mark Prius. The facts of this case include that the Toyota launched its first commercial hybrid car in Japan and in other countries in 1997, but it failed to register the trademark in India for whatever reasons. The respondent, Prius Auto Industries, got the trademark registered in India in 2002. And subsequently, the Toyota's car was introduced in India in 2009. The appellant, then Prius Auto filed a case before the High Court saying that the mark has, Toyota has infringed its mark. However, Toyota argued that its mark is a well-known mark and has acquired immense reputation, which requires protection in the Indian courts, in Indian market. However, the Supreme Court held that the party has, in this case, even though it was recognized that, yes, Prius is Toyota's trademark, the Supreme Court held that the party has to show reputation and goodwill in a particular territory. So here the issue arose of universality doctrine or territoriality doctrine, where territoriality doctrine and goodwill and transborder reputation in a particular territory was given predominance over universality doctrine. Secondly, Exide Industries Limited versus Exide Corporation USA. The issue in this case revolved around the trademark Exide. In 1997, when the Exide US entered the Indian market, the Indian company Exide Industries, which had been present for decades, filed a suit for infringement of trademark before the Delhi High Court. The Exide US was restrained from, the single judge restrained Exide US from using the trademark in India. The division bench actually came out with a very interesting decision where both the companies were held to be genuine users of the mark, and it was held that there is no infringement or passing off. The mark had been, in fact, one of the facts of the matters were that the mark had been initially assigned by Exide US to Exide Industries in India by an agreement, but Exide US had kept the goodwill aspect to it with itself. Exide Industries India then went and appealed before the Supreme Court, and Exide US was again restrained from using the mark till the outcome of the suit. But during the course of the proceedings, the matter was settled out of court, and US Exide waived its rights of the mark Exide in India. However, this created an interesting discussion over the fact that, yes, even though Exide US was a prior user and as well as a well-known user of the mark, again, the territorial aspect of use of the mark was given predominance over the universality doctrine of the mark. Another recently interesting case is that the registration of And Then There Were None, which is one of the best-selling books of Agatha Christie, originally published in 1939, and 80 years later, when registration of it was filed before the registrar in India, the registration of the trademark And Then There Were None was rejected, leading to filing of the case before the Delhi High Court. The Delhi High Court in this matter then went into the relevance of distinctiveness of the trademark and held that essentially if the trademark is distinctive and is not identical or confusingly or deceptively similar to any earlier mark which is registered or in use from a prior date in respect of similar goods or services or which results in passing off, then such a trademark deserves registration. Recently, contrary to the decision in the Agatha Christie case, another decision which was passed by the Delhi High Court itself is in Hamdard National Foundation India versus other laboratories. In this, the plaintiff had brought a suit against the respondents for using Dil Afza, claiming deceptive similarity and passing off on the ground that the plaintiff's trademark Ruh Afza, Ruh and Dil connote the same meaning and emotion, and furthermore, their bottles were also similar, causing confusion in the public. The court, in my opinion, wrongly held that Ruh and Dil involve separate emotions, and it's not deep enough to the extent that the plaintiffs have hyped it up. In any case, the court held that in any case, those who appreciate this deep emotion would be the first to be able to distinguish Ruh and Dil. However, we are concerned with the common user to whom in ordinary use of the word Dil and Ruh do not denote the same thing. There cannot be confusion being created on account of meaning of the two words. On this basis, the claim of the plaintiffs was denied. In my personal opinion, I think Ruafza being a well-known mark should have been granted protection, but let us see if this case goes into appeal and what happens. Now, another relevant aspect in the present times is the statutory provision of Section 79(3) and the protection given to intermediaries under the Information Technology Act. The intermediaries in this case have a discretion to decide and defenses to take whether a certain content or certain infringer can be the content of the infringer or the listing of such an infringer can be blocked. In this regard, Shreya Singhal versus Union of India is the landmark judgment, which I understand should be in your course, but which requires that intermediaries are supposed to take down or block content upon notification of such takedown or received from the government agency or a court, and not on the and it does not depend upon the discretion of the intermediaries or on the receipt of requests by the affected person. However, today the situation has changed. If there is an infringement being carried out on a site such as on an e-commerce site such as Amazon or Flipkart, you can a registered proprietor can go in and ask for takedown of such listings, and they can file a request with Amazon or Flipkart and at their own discretion, or they can take down the request based on the facts and materials provided to it. In this regard, there are several other judgments also which are relevant. In MySpace Inc. versus Supercassettes, this is with respect to the defenses which can be taken if an e-commerce website is made a party to a suit. It gives the importance of safe harbor under Section 79 and Section 81 of the Information Technology Act, where the e-commerce website or can claim or the intermediary can claim immunity that it did not have an actual knowledge of the infringement. Then Kent RO Systems, Amit Kotal, again, for a case to be made out under Section 79(3), conspiracy or abetment or aiding of the intermediary needs to be proved by the plaintiff. Again, in Kent RO Systems, directions were given by the court to the intermediary to remove the listing within a certain time period. In Banyan Tree Holdings case, the court simply assessing using a website in Delhi or any other state would not justify jurisdictional qualifications of the court. You have to, in this regard, you have to prove that the product was delivered or is being, the website is available in a certain territorial jurisdiction or not. This was my presentation on trademarks and litigation aspects. Now, if any of you have any questions, you're welcome to ask. Yes, Ijaz.
Yes, ma'am. So my doubt is regarding the possibility of consider this these days. We are hearing about metaverse is emerging as a very a buzz in the market. So I was thinking, I mean, I recently came across that as hypothetical situation that suppose a product being seen, I mean, a registered trademark is there in metaverse platform, and at the same time the person who is opposing that is not being there within this metaverse. So what would be the possible chance of that he is getting a win situation from this? I mean, if this is a hypothetical I'm just putting it as a hypothetical situation. So consider this metaverse is in emerging and its scope in India. I'm just curious to know that.
I think that's a very interesting aspect that the courts may have to deal with in the future. Of course, the abstract nature of the infringer, the possibility of identifying the infringer, all of these would create a huge problem for the person bringing in the suit or the claim itself. I do not know how India will go ahead with it. And metaverse, of course, will lead to problems for Meta or Facebook itself. But I mean, you can have a discussion over it with amongst yourself as to what could be the relevance of metaverse in terms of trademark infringement or any other IPR infringement. It will need the level of proof required would be different and not just high.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, Dipanshi.
So my question is that if we go to file an application for trademark and there is a conflicting mark ABC and our trademark is ABCZ, then registry files an objection that your trademark is similar to this ABC thing. But there are several cases which say that trademark should not be broken and then see, like they should not be separated in words to see if they are similar or not. Yet registry keeps on objecting on this basis, and then we file replies and then state cases like this is the case where the court held this and you should not object, and that's how it goes. So when there are already cases, why it's like very practical thing, why registry keeps on objecting to it? I've seen this in many cases that they do this, they break this and then they file an objection and then we have to file a reply.
I think once when you enter litigation, you will understand that trademark is such a niche field as well as such a wide field that each and every case, even though there are landmark cases, there are certain guidelines which have been given by the court, there are lot many examples, each and every case has to be seen on its own legs and in the under the facts and circumstances which have been given to the court or to the registry. Now, registry more often than not goes in a very blocked manner or in a very bookish manner or legal manner. The powers which the registry have are not as wide as the powers that a court has. So it all basically depends on the facts and circumstances of the case. If you're not satisfied with the decision of the registry, you can always challenge it before the court. However, again, it would all depend on the facts and circumstances of the case. If you're able to establish the use, the prior use, the consumer base, the reputation, goodwill, everything put together, if you're able to prove, you can get your similar trademark also registered.
All right, ma'am. Thank you. Also, it's a follow-up question. A different question, obviously. When we do a trademark search report, the examination search report or a status search report, then device marks also come under the report of word mark search report. So if someone has this device mark registered with ABC and you want to get a word mark registered with ABC or ABCZ, then is it possible to do so?
Yes, you can get it registered both as a device mark and a word mark. As the name would suggest, a device mark would constitute more than just words. You will have to take it as a whole. It might include the color, the script, everything put together, maybe a logo also included in it. But word mark would only include the registration of the word as it is. It would not include any kind of ornamentation, any kind of fringe material which is required.
Right. So what if the device mark is registered with entity A, but the entity B wants to get a word mark over that?
I think Vrinda would be able to deal with the prosecution aspect of the questions. But again, this would involve a lot of trial. It would involve you giving proof or you filing the proceedings before the registry, as well as if you want to take it forward before the court. It depends on how important is your mark to you. If you want to get the word mark registered, and usually device mark and word marks, if they're similar, even though the device mark has the word mark, if it's infringing on, if either are infringing on a prior registered mark, trademark, then it's not allowed registration.
All right, ma'am. Thanks a lot.
Akshay, Aditya, Anjani all have questions. One by one, you can ask.
Hello, ma'am. Ma'am, I have a question regarding, like, there's a company 30-40 years old and it's a foreign company. So it has its trademark registered in the foreign country, but not in India. And they've started their business like 10 years back in India by e-commerce sites and all, Amazon.
Right.
And in India, there's a company like Indian owned, and it has the same trademark, but it's registered in 2011 in India. But the foreign company's trademark is not registered in India, but it registered its trademark 30 years back in its own country.
Mm-hmm.
But when, so now the foreign country, the foreign company is like, the Indian company has the same trademark, so they want to injure that. Like they want to make a case about it and want to stop them from using it because it's a old company and very renowned all over the world. So which one will, like, what will happen in this case? Like foreign company will can move forward with this or not? Like what will Trademarks Act will agree with? Like the Indian company will suffice or foreign company will win?
Statutorily, I would say that going by the decisions of the court will give primacy to the trademark which has been registered in India. But if the other company is able to show use in India prior to the registered trademark in India, or is able to show well-knownness of the mark or goodwill in the Indian market, then it will depend, again, like I mentioned earlier, that when you do trademarks law, completely depends on facts and circumstances of each case. Whichever party is able to show immense use, the wideness of the use, the customer base, yes, registration always is given a primacy, but they can also be allowed to simultaneously exist in this regard.
Okay, ma'am. So basically, like, it's more than just an act in trademarks law. We can go beyond that also.
That's right.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, I have a question. Like in defenses, alongside prior use, we can also take fair use, honest and concurrent use. So I am a little bit confused about what difference actually roll out among fair use and honest and concurrent use.
Actually, there's not proper difference between fair, concurrent and honest use are similar in terms of definitions. They all include the aspect that there shouldn't be an infringement which is intentional. Maybe a person started using, say, Usha for the same similar kind of products around the same time without being aware or without having the knowledge that yes, another person having the trademark Usha exists. If the defendant is able to show such an honest adoption, and concurrent means at the same time or around the same time, adoption of the mark, and which is fair in the sense that you are able to show that your adoption is also can be allowed by the courts. They all flow into each other, of course. So I cannot say that there's a proper difference or there's a significant difference between each of those, because all of these defenses actually do flow into each other and all of these have to be shown to the court at the same time. It's not that you just show fair use or honest use and prior use, just that, and your case will survive on its own legs.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, so basically, as you mentioned that, I would like to ask a question about the specific case that has recently been, like Delhi High Court gave a judgment in the Ruobza case, where there was a very similar product overlap. So I just want to know that, is there somewhere defined that this much overlap is allowed, or it totally depends on the fact of the case or discretion of the court? Because the product was very similar. They had the same name, almost same product design.
Yes, the latter. That is what I am insisting, that when you enter practice, you will realize that it completely depends on facts and circumstances of each case and how much you're able to prove, how much infringement you're able to prove, and also the discretion. If maybe a product does not look similar to the judge, one judge, then you will not get an injunction order. If maybe to another person, it might look similar. However, of course, it's basically how you present your case. In this regard, yes, even I agree. It's my personal opinion that the products are very similar and the injunction should have been granted, but it depended upon the judge who was listening to the case.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, ma'am, for such an informative session. And now to welcome our next speaker, Mr. Love Virmani, who is an associate at Singh and Singh LLP. Mr. Virmani handles matters pertaining to trademarks, patents, copyright, disparagement, and drug regulatory issues. He has represented many domestic as well as multinational clients, including leading media and entertainment companies, financial service providers, FMCG companies, and e-commerce platforms before different courts. He has 5 years of experience in the field of IP litigation and having practiced in three different states. He is a member of Asian Patent Attorneys Association, India Group. He has completed his BBA LLB from Institute of Law, Nirma University, Ahmedabad, with a specialization in intellectual property rights. In the year 2017, he has published research papers on various contemporary issues, such as the protection and scope of non-conventional trademarks, revamping cybersecurity in the COVID-19 era, and the need for regulation of content of news television channels. Welcome, sir. Please, the stage is yours.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Love Virmani. I will be delivering the session on copyright filing and litigation. Before I start, I must acknowledge and appreciate the efforts of Ms. Bitika Sharma and Professor Dr. Alka Chawla for organizing this amazing workshop. I think this is a wonderful exercise and it's going to be very helpful for all the students, especially those who are in third year and are ready to enter the field in a few months. So I will try to cover as many concepts of copyright law as possible in the next 30 minutes. During the session, I will ask you certain questions which you are required to answer, and I will take your questions after the session. So for the initial 2 minutes, I will briefly discuss a couple of theoretical concepts and then we'll jump to the practical aspects of copyright law. Okay, so before jumping to the subject matter of copyright, let's see what is copyright. Copyright, as you're aware, is a type of intellectual property that gives its owner the exclusive right to copy and distribute the creative work. Now, there are two objectives of copyright. One is, of course, to incentivize the creator so as to enable him or motivate him to generate more creative works. And the second important aspect is to maximize public access to the content that is created by the creators. Now, it is well settled law that copyright is intended to protect only the original expression of an idea in the form of a creative work, but not the idea itself. To put it in simple words, so copyright exists not in an idea, but only in its expression. This has been held by the Supreme Court also in the case of R.G. Anand versus Deluxe Films. I'm sure that you're all aware of it. So now let's see what types of works can be protected by copyright. That is to say, what is the subject matter of copyright? You'll see in section 16, these have been listed. First, there are literary works, which includes books, articles, poems, examination papers, computer softwares. Then we have dramatic works, which includes plays, theaters. Musical works also are protected under copyright. So musical works means the music of a sound recording or a song, not the entire song. And this music which has been composed can be represented in musical notes or musical sheets. Then we have artistic works, which includes photographs, paintings, drawings. Then, of course, we have cinematograph films and sound recordings. So this is the subject matter of copyright, which is clearly given in section 13 of the Act. Now let's briefly talk about copyright filing. I'll not spend more than 2 minutes on this. This is again something purely theoretical. So an application for registration of copyright can be filed before the Copyright Office. It can be filed under Form 14. It's available in the first schedule to the copyright rules and it's also available on the copyright website. Now this application, of course, needs to be accompanied with the fees which is set out in Schedule 2 of the rules and of course the works which are to be over which the person is obtaining copyright. Then again, it is well settled principle of law that registration for copyright is not mandatory. Now, I have written a couple of cases. One is from Delhi High Court, the other is from Bombay High Court, which have held that copyright registration is not mandatory. It's optional. You may also refer to Section 45 of the Act, because the Section 45, it says that the author of the owner of copyright may make an application for entering the particulars of the work in the register of copyrights. So since it uses the words may and not shall, the courts have held that this provision is not mandatory, it's optional. Now you may think that if it's optional, it's not mandatory, then what's the use of getting registration of copyright? The answer to that is that there are certain advantages which are connected to obtaining registration. And the foremost advantage is that your copyright registration will be considered as a prima facie evidence of your copyright. So you may also refer to section 48 for this, because section 48 of the Copyright Act, it says that register of copyright to be prima facie evidence of particulars entered therein. Now we can deal with the practical aspects. The very important question which may come to your mind, that why you all should be interested in copyright litigation. So first of all, it's a fast growing area of law, and because of technological advancements, we see two things. One, that we keep coming across new subject matters of copyright, such as computer softwares. These did not exist earlier and were not protected under copyright, but gradually with the advancement of technology, things like computer softwares have come under the purview of copyright. Second, we also see new forms of infringement. This is again because of technological advancements. For example, I'll just explain with an example of dynamic injunctions. So dynamic injunctions is a concept which has now been adopted by Indian courts. So what used to happen was that when there were infringing websites or pirated websites, and a plaintiff used to approach the court used to issue an order saying that the particular web page which is infringing or which is circulating the pirated content is to be blocked. That is how the courts used to deal with it earlier. Then what happened was that the infringers came out with new ways to overcome these injunctions. What the infringers did was they copied the contents of the infringing web page from one web page to another web page of the same website. Now, when the courts came across this situation, the courts expanded the scope of the injunction order, and the courts started holding that not just the web pages, but the entire website of the which contains the infringing content will be blocked. Now, the infringers did not stop at this. They again, because of technological developments, they came up with the concept of redirect websites or mirror websites, as I think you may have heard of these concepts. So an example is, suppose there's an infringing or pirated website which has the domain name abc.com. Now the plaintiff, when approaches the court grants an injunction and says that the website abc.com will be blocked. Now what the infringer does is that the infringer will create a mirror website which will have the domain name abc1.com, and the entire contents of abc1.com will be copied to abc1.com, and so on. That is when the Indian courts adopted the concept of dynamic injunction. Dynamic injunctions, by definition, it means that the injunction will be dynamic. It will apply dynamically, it will not be static. So initially the injunction will be granted only to injunct one particular website. But if the infringer creates mirror websites or redirect websites of the initial infringing website, then the injunction order will apply to those websites also. So as you may see in this case, the case is UTV Software Communication. This is a Delhi High Court judgment. The case is UTV Software Communication versus 1337x.to and others. So in this case, this is a prime example where you can see that the infringers and the courts have been in a race of technological advancement, where the infringers keep coming up with new concepts to infringe copyright, and the courts, you know, keep coming with new legal remedies to contain such actions of infringement. Now, next, let's see another thing which may interest you is when copyright infringement instances qualify as cyber crimes or white collar crimes or criminal offenses. Then third point why you should be interested in copyright litigation is because there is always high commercial value attached to the subject matter of copyright. Now, be it books, songs, musical compositions, movie scripts, computer softwares, all these things require a lot of time and money to be created, and there is high commercial value attached to these subject matters of copyright. And lastly, see, there's always an advantage of specialization. So not many people know how to deal with copyright matters, and it will be an advantage when you practice because your specialization will make you stand out. So I'll take a pause, just 1 second, for all those who have missed seeing this. Just take a quick look. I just explained these two slides and then we'll go to the next topic. So now if you go through the Copyright Act, you'll see that the acts which constitute copyright infringement are clearly given in Section 51 of the Act. But merely by looking at the section, it is very difficult to imagine that how and when do these provisions would apply. And therefore, I will discuss some situations when copyright infringement cases are triggered. And in my experience, I have seen that most copyright infringement litigations revolve around these scenarios which are on your screen now. So the first scenario which we commonly see is where infringement, copyright infringement takes place on digital or online spaces. Now these spaces can be categorized into subcategories. The four prominent categories are cloud storage platforms. We see a lot of times that notes or study materials or examination papers or newspapers are being shared on cloud storage platforms. An example of this is Google Drive. So suppose a lot of people, they circulate links of Google Drive on WhatsApp or Telegram or on all such platforms. These links contain the Google Drive link, which has stored the infringing content. Next, we see copyright infringement on e-commerce marketplaces. Now, this happens when there is unauthorized listing of products which are protected under copyright on e-commerce websites. Then, under the category of infringement on digital and online spaces, we also see infringement taking place on music and video streaming platforms. These may be mobile applications also. And these instances are triggered when a song is unauthorizedly shared, played, or uploaded on a music streaming platform. For example, Spotify, Gaana, JioSaavn, YouTube, Wink. I'm sure you all would have used these platforms. Lastly, we also see a lot of copyright infringement happening on social media platforms like Facebook or Instagram. When something which is subject matter of copyright, which has been protected under copyright, and such material has been uploaded on these platforms without the owner's consent. Now, when we talk about these kinds of infringement on digital spaces, online spaces, there are two things happening simultaneously. One is the uploader who creates or copies and infringes the content. Second is the hosting platform on which this infringing content is uploaded. So presently I'm talking only about the hosting platform, because in a lot of cases we see that parties do initiate actions for copyright infringement against these hosting platforms also. Basically platforms which host infringing content. And there's a statutory provision also for this. If you see Section 51A2 of the Copyright Act, that deals with what we commonly call secondary infringement. It means the term secondary infringement may not be used in the Act, but that is what we commonly call it. And this provision provides that the act of permitting one's place, whether physical or digital, to be used for communicating infringing work to the public with a view to earn profits from it constitutes infringement of copyright. The second category of cases which we commonly see in courts is when copying of artistic work of a logo or a packaging takes place. Now, mostly we see this happening with food products, because sometimes what the infringer tries to do is that it will copy the artistic work of a packaging. It will make all attempts to make the packaging look similar, but it will not copy the trademark or the trade name. Now, while doing so, the infringer thinks that he has evaded liability, but that is not the case, because even though he may evade liability for trademark infringement, it will still amount to copyright infringement. Then we have cases where the contents of a website are imitated and they're copied to another website. a very interesting case which we dealt with was when we filed a case on behalf of India Bulls in 2019 before the Delhi High Court, because our clients came across a website which had copied the entire contents of our client's website. Not just that, even the brand ambassador, so India Bulls brand ambassador at that time was MS Dhoni, and even the photo of MS Dhoni was copied by the infringer on his own website. So we filed this suit before the Delhi High Court and we were able to obtain an injunction on it on the very first day. Then we see copying of books and articles. This is very straightforward. We also see infringement of computer software. Like I said, that this is something which was not very common earlier, but now it's very common. We see a lot of cases. Again, an interesting case which we dealt with was that we were representing the defendants in this case. We are representing, in fact. The matter is presently pending before the Delhi High Court. And the case pertains to infringement of copyright in a software. And the plaintiff's allegations, the plaintiffs allege that the defendants have copied the source code of the plaintiff's software. But the plaintiffs do not stop there. They also make an allegation that the defendants have not just copied the source code, but the defendants are also servicing the plaintiff's software. And while servicing the plaintiff's software, the defendants are modifying the source code of the plaintiff. And therefore, this amounts to copyright infringement. So these are some cases which you will see that apart from legal knowledge, you may also require some technical expertise to deal with such cases where infringement of copyright in a computer software is alleged. Then there are instances, and I'm sure you would be aware of these, that when songs are played in parties, hotel premises, events without due permission from the copyright owner. Now, what is also common is that after these parties take place, the organizers receive legal notices from the copyright owner of those sound recordings or the songs. These legal notices demand licensing fees, claiming that so and so song was played in so and so party or an event without authorization from the owner, and therefore a licensing fee has to be paid. Now, when the organizer refuses to pay the licensing fee, it results in copyright litigation. You may refer to section 52(1)(ZA) of the Copyright Act, which provides an exception in these scenarios. And this exception is for religious ceremonies, and this includes marriage processions and all social festivities which are associated with marriage. Then lastly, you may come across instances when the copyright which is alleged to be infringed is of a derivative work. Now, see, there are two kinds of works over which copyright can be claimed. One is original work and one is derivative work. Now, when the copyright is claimed in an original work and your client has a copyright, when your client has copyright over an original work and he approaches you to file an infringement case, the path is pretty straightforward. But when the work of your client is itself derivative work, then it becomes a bit tricky, because when the work is derivative, the very first thing that you need to ensure is that this derivative work has been created in compliance with the requirements of the Copyright Act. I'll give you one example. Suppose one of your clients has created a remix song. Now, derivative works are those which are derived from original works. So derivative works may, when we talk about songs, derivative works may be a remix or a remake or a medley, mashup, cover version, so on. Now, when your client approaches you, the client says that I created a certain remix song and someone else has copied that song. So the very first thing that you need to ascertain as the lawyer of this client is that your client, while creating the remix work, the remix song, obtained the due permissions from the original copyright owner. Because in such cases, if you file an action for infringement, the very first thing which the defendant will raise is that your work is not liable to be protected under copyright. It lacks originality. And you will be stuck at that stage. So I'll again give an example from one of the cases which we are dealing with, and that is again pending before the Delhi High Court, so I cannot divulge much information. But what happened was that there was a dispute between a teacher and a student, and we are representing the teacher. And what the student did was that the student copied the entire notes of his teacher. In fact, the student just took the notes and uploaded these notes on YouTube, and the student started monetizing these notes. There was the name of the teacher written on the notes, and the student removed the name just and then shared those notes on YouTube and started earning money from this. Now we filed an action for infringement saying that the notes belong to the teacher and you cannot do this, and the student is also liable and YouTube of course is also liable. That is a separate question. But what the student did in his defense, he raised the question of originality or copyrightability of the notes. And the student said that the notes of the teacher have been copied from the textbooks. So this is not worthy of copyright protection. Again, there was an injunction granted in this case also, but that's purely on facts. But I just want to make you all aware that these are the challenges that you will face when you are representing a client who wants to protect derivative works and not original works. Lastly, you will come across instances where infringement pertains to underlying works. Now, what are underlying works? This particular category pertains only to sound recordings, which are songs. Now, when you listen to a song, it is comprised of different components, which are music, lyrics, and so on. So the song itself, the song is called sound recording in legal terms, in copyright law in India. And the song, of course, is worthy of copyright protection, but the underlying works, which are the lyrics, which have been written by the lyricist, or the music, which have been composed by the composer, are also entitled to copyright protection, independent copyright protection, separate from the song. And therefore, in instances when someone copies only the music or the lyrics or the words of a song, and if that person thinks that he is not liable for copyright infringement, then that is not correct, because you may not be infringing the entire song, but you are still infringing the lyrics or the music, whichever part you have copied from the song. Next, discussing defenses or exceptions to copyright infringement. These are the four most prominent defenses which you will see in courts, which are being taken up by the defendants in copyright infringement matters. The first, of course, is that there is no similarity between the plaintiff's and the defendant's work. This is a very obvious defense and there is no need to discuss this in detail. The second defense, which I just discussed, is lack of originality in the claimant's work. The teacher-student example. Then we have the fair dealing exception and safe harbor protection. I'll be dealing with these two defenses in detail, number three and number four. Let's first see what is fair dealing exception. Now, fair dealing exception is covered under section 52 of the Copyright Act, and it protects such works from infringement suits if they are being accessed for, say, private use, personal use, research purposes, education purposes, journalistic purposes, you know. So in such instances, or academic purposes, in such instances, fair dealing is a significant limitation on the exclusive right of the copyright owner. Now, section 52, if you see, it is a very long section and it contains a long list of all the acts which do not amount to copyright infringement. But I will discuss the major types of fair dealing exceptions that have been dealt with by the courts in India. Let's see at the first case, which is University of Oxford versus Rameshwari Photocopy Services. This is commonly known as the Delhi University Photocopy case. I am sure that you all would have heard of this case. And in this case, the Delhi High Court held that course packs are exempted and they're covered under the fair dealing exception because they are being used in educational instruction under section 52(1)(i) of the Act. So the court held that preparation of course packs, which are compilation of photocopies of relevant portions of different books prescribed in the syllabus, do not constitute infringement of copyright as long as the inclusion of the works which are photocopied is justified by the purpose of educational instruction. So the court also held that the quantity which is photocopied is absolutely irrelevant. If the photocopies qualify as a reproduction of work by a teacher in the course of instruction, this is very important. And therefore the court held that such course packs, they constitute fair dealing under section 52(1)(i) of the Act. Next, we have the University of Cambridge versus B.D. Bhandari case. This is again a Delhi High Court decision. You can see the citations on your screen. In this case, the court granted protection to guidebooks. So in the DU photocopy case, we saw that protection being granted to course packs, which are compilation of photocopies of relevant portions of books. Now in University of Cambridge versus B.D. Bhandari, we are seeing that guidebooks are also exempted, because guidebooks, in the opinion of the court, are considered as a review of another work, which is covered under section 52(1)(a)(2) of the Copyright Act. I'll just repeat, it's considered as a review of another work under section 52(1)(a)(2) of the Copyright Act. So in this case, the court held that a guidebook has to be, in this case, what was seen by the court, that the guidebook, which was subject matter of this dispute of copyright infringement, this guidebook was materially different from the textbook, which was the work of the plaintiff. And the court said that if the guidebook provides an explanation, a step-by-step process, or a detailed analysis of any problem, which is not there in the original book, and this step-by-step analysis is provided in the guidebook to reach the answer and to make the task simpler in understanding the subject, then it will be treated as a different work and fair dealing exception will apply. So the court characterized these works, which are materially different because they contain step-by-step processes, explanations, the court categorized these works as transformative works. And the court said that it is to be ascertained whether the purpose served by the guidebook, please note, is substantially different from the purpose served by the textbook. Now, how do you say that the purpose served is different? The court held that the guidebooks were designed to cater to a category of students who are weak in their understanding of subject, and therefore the purpose of the guidebook is different from the purpose of the textbook, and that is why fair dealing exception was granted in this case, because the court held that the guidebooks, they qualify as transformative works and they amount to review under section 52 of the Copyright Act. Then we have a Supreme Court decision at number 3, which is Academy of General Education, Manipal and others versus V. Malini Malia. Now in this case, this is a very short case, but since it's a Supreme Court decision, it becomes important. In this case, the fair dealing exception was granted to a performance, to a dance performance in a college, because it was held by the court, by the Supreme Court, that the performance in the course of activities of an educational institution does not amount to infringement and is protected under section 52 of the Act. This was a dance form and it was performed by someone at the educational institution, and the original copyright owner in the dance form initiated an action for copyright infringement, saying that my permission was not taken when this was performed. And the court held that the defendant, being an educational institution, if the dance is performed within the meaning of clause J, please note, clause J of subsection 1 of section 52 of the Copyright Act, it would not amount to infringement of copyright and injunction would not be granted. Then let's quickly see the case of Super Cassettes versus Hummer Television. This is again a short case, and but an important one. Here, why this is important? Because the fair dealing exception was not permitted by the court. Why? Because the musical works which were broadcasted in this case, they were not relevant to the program. which was being broadcasted, and there the infringement was claimed with regard to musical works. If I remember correctly, these musical works were some songs from the movie Gajni, which were played on a Bhojpuri television show. And the court said that the playing of these songs has no relevance whatsoever to the show which is being broadcast. The utilization of these musical works is not for educational purposes, it is not for review, not for criticism or current affairs, and therefore the fair dealing exception will not be extended in this case. Next, we'll deal with the safe harbor protection. Now, like what I discussed a few minutes back, when we talk about infringement on digital platforms or e-commerce websites or streaming platforms, these entities usually seek defense under Section 79 of the Information Technology Act. Please note Section 79 of the Information Technology Act 2000. And this is known as the safe harbor protection. Now, what they argue is that they cannot monitor the products being sold on the websites, and they cannot monitor all the content which is available on the website or on the streaming platform, and therefore they should not be held liable for copyright infringement. These entities argue that they are intermediaries. Now, intermediary is a term which is defined under Section 2W of the Information Technology Act. This provision defines what is an intermediary, and these digital platforms, online marketplaces, streaming platforms, all these entities usually claim to be intermediaries, and they claim that they are protected under the safe harbor protection granted under Section 79 of the Information Technology Act. Now we'll see how this applies. Examples of such entities, of course, like I said, are Twitter, Facebook, Google, YouTube, domain name registrars like GoDaddy. All these entities claim that they are, before at least the Indian courts, they claim that they are intermediaries and they are entitled to the safe harbor protection, which is to say that they cannot monitor the content and they will take down the content. Now this has been, this was discussed by Shifa also when she was discussing the Shreya Singhal judgment, that these entities say that they will take down the content as and when they receive an order from the court, and that is what was held by the court also. Now, what is the definition of intermediaries? Like I said, it's given in Section 2W of the Information Technology Act, and it includes telecom service providers, internet service providers, network service providers, search engines, online payment sites, online marketplaces, and so on. The list is non-exhaustive. Now, if you would recall, I just told you that there's a kind of infringement which is secondary infringement, which is covered under Section 51(a)(2) of the Copyright Act. Although that term is not used in the provision, but that is how we commonly call such kind of infringement. So this section provides that the act of permitting one's place, whether physical or digital, to be used to communicate infringing work to the public with a view to earn profits, this will constitute infringement of copyright. I'll give you a simple example. Suppose you are the owner of a library, a huge library, and that library, of course, is a lot of people borrow books from that library and they pay you some money. Now, one day I show up and I say that it has come to my knowledge that my book is unauthorizedly kept in your library. Please remove that book and please ensure that the book is not kept in your is not seen in your library again, because I have not given any consent or authorization to you. Now, I have not named the book. I have not told you what is the location of the book. I simply say that my book is in the library, please remove it. Then, you being the owner of library, your immediate response would be that you will ask me to point out the name and location of the book. But I am the author of the book and my book is circulated worldwide. So my response will be that it is not my duty to tell you or tell all the libraries in the entire world to go to each and every library and ensure that my book is not there. Since you are earning money from the library, it is your duty that you do not keep any infringing material in your premises. So this is the simple issue which we see with intermediaries also. Because to put it in simple words, the core issue which we see is that who will bear the burden of locating the infringing content? The copyright owner does not want to take that burden upon himself. The intermediaries do not want to take that burden upon themselves. And that is the dispute. And that is why so many litigations involving these parties, which take years and a lot of money is spent in courts, fighting over the burden of locating infringing content. Now, there are these three cases which are landmark judgments with regard to safe harbor protection. But Shifa already has already dealt with these judgments, so I will not discuss these in detail. I'll in fact just briefly discuss the third judgment, which is Christian Roberton versus Nakul Bajaj. Now, this is a Delhi High Court judgment, and the Delhi High Court, it laid down 26 non-exhaustive elements that would be key to determining whether a website has services stated that is defined under section 2W of the IT Act, which defines what is an intermediary. So it laid down the guidelines. This is specific to e-commerce marketplaces, but it laid down the guidelines that which websites will qualify as intermediaries as far as e-commerce websites are concerned. First. Second, this judgment says that if the intermediaries, they fail to observe due diligence. Now, please note down these words, due diligence. This is very important, and this is not a general term. This is of course a general term, but it has certain legal meaning attached to it. So the court held in this judgment that if the intermediaries, they fail to observe due diligence with respect to intellectual property rights, then it would qualify these entities from claiming the safe harbor protection, which is given under section 79. So if you are representing a client in a copyright infringement litigation and the client wants to claim safe harbor protection, then as per this judgment, you'll see that there are two stages. First of all, you will have to establish that you are an intermediary as per the definition under 2W of IT Act. Second, you will have to show that you observed due diligence, which is required under section 79 of the Act. You cannot stop at step one, because safe harbor protection is not a blanket immunity which is granted to intermediaries. You have to show what is due diligence. And section 79 of course provides that that due diligence is required to be observed by intermediaries if they want to claim the safe harbor protection. And what is due diligence is provided if you can see, I've written as point number 5, Information Technology Rules of 2021. You'll go through these rules. There is a list of requirements which intermediaries are expected to comply if they wish to claim the safe harbor protection in India. So we are done with the safe harbor protection. Now, there are some litigations which you should be following if you are interested in copyright law. The first one is the Lahari Recording Company versus Union of India writ petition, which is pending before the Supreme Court presently. This is important because the statutory licensing and compulsory licensing provisions of the Copyright Act, the constitutionality of these provisions has been challenged before the Supreme Court, and this litigation is still pending. Although there is a Madras High Court judgment which says that these provisions are constitutional, but nevertheless, it is important to see what the Supreme Court holds on this. So statutory licensing, again, it's a theoretical concept, and I think it would be covered in your syllabus. Statutory licensing you will find in section 31 and compulsory licensing in section 31D of the Copyright Act. Next, we have the ENIL versus PPL India and others dispute. Now, I just explained that there are underlying works in sound recordings which are independent copyrightable works. And the question which is pending before the division bench of Delhi High Court in ENIL versus PPL dispute is whether separate royalty rates shall be fixed for underlying works in sound recordings. So we are yet to see what is the decision of this case, but you may note down this judgment. It would be useful in your career. Then we have the GCMF and another versus Amul Franchise.in and others. This is again a dispute pending before the Delhi High Court, wherein Amul has alleged that, so I'll briefly tell you the facts of this case. So what was happening is that there were a lot of websites, fake websites, fraudulent websites, infringing websites coming up with the domain name of Amul. And Amul filed a suit before Delhi High Court against all these websites. What Amul also did was it made GoDaddy a party, a defendant in this suit, because GoDaddy was the registrar of these infringing domain names. And Amul, what Amul has submitted before the court is that GoDaddy should be injuncted from registering infringing domain names containing the word Amul in future also. GoDaddy in its defense has submitted that there cannot be pre-screening of names, and therefore there cannot be any blanket injunction order on future actions. So GoDaddy's submission is that the registration of domain names, it's a completely automated process. There is least or no human intervention involved. And in fact, this is a trademarks case, but the decision of this case will have huge implications on copyright law also, because the intermediaries or the entities which claim to be intermediaries, they say that they cannot monitor the content which is being hosted on their platforms, because the process of hosting the content is automatic. They say that there are hundreds of files being uploaded on the platform every second, and it is technologically impossible to monitor all the content. Lastly, you need to watch out for any judgment which comes on the question whether copyright infringement is a bailable or non-bailable offense, or it's a cognizable or non-cognizable offense. Now, as you would have read in Copyright Act Section 63 and 68A, these provide for criminal offenses, and there are punishments including imprisonment attached to these offenses. Now, different high courts have given different views on this question, whether copyright infringement is a bailable or non-bailable or cognizable or non-cognizable offense. The police, of course, can register FIRs, but this question has not been, it's not consistent throughout the country. So you need to keep looking for judgments in the future which address this. Now, lastly, I'll just quickly give you some useful tips for dealing in copyright litigation, since you are all upcoming lawyers in copyright litigation, intellectual property rights litigation. First and foremost, you should know how to determine jurisdiction. You'll have to be thorough with two sections. One is Section 20 of the CPC, and the other section is Section 62 of the Copyright Act. Now, copyright and trademarks acts, these are special acts where the plaintiffs have been given the statutory rights to institute suits for infringement in the court within which the plaintiff resides or carries on business. You will not see these provisions in other statutes. And therefore, it is very important, because when these provisions were being drafted, the intention of the legislature was to encourage parties to protect their intellectual property rights by instituting cases in courts of their convenience. Next, you should be thorough with the procedure, the procedural aspects of law, the procedural aspects on civil and commercial side. You have to read CPC for that. And as Shifa already explained, you have to be thorough with the stages of the suit. First is the interim stage. Then there is framing of issues, which is decided as per the pleadings which have been submitted by the parties. The pleadings, of course, are the plaint and written statement. Then evidence is led on the issues which are framed. And lastly, final arguments take place. Then it is important that you attend virtual hearings during your internships, because that's an advantage which you all have, which no one else has ever had. Then your focus should be on securing interim relief. The first focus should be on securing interim relief. There are three factors which are to be seen by the court while deciding the question of interim injunction. When we come to the question and answer session, I would want someone to answer this question for me, that what are the three factors which will be considered by the court while deciding the question of interim injunction. Then it is also important that you keep in mind that any sort of delay in instituting the proceedings on behalf of your client can be detrimental to your client's case. Filing within period of limitation and filing at the earliest possible opportunity, these are two different things. You need to understand the difference between these two things. Filing within the period of limitation and filing the suit at the earliest possible opportunity. You should understand the difference between these two things. It's very important because many times interim injunction is denied by the court if there has been any delay on part of the plaintiff in instituting the suit. Then it is also important for all of you to learn how to frame the right questions for the court. A lot of times you will see that the other side will try to distract the court, will take the court to another question altogether, which is not even relevant for the purpose of adjudicating your case. If you take the example of trademark law, so the question which has to be seen by the court is not whether there is actual proof of confusion. The question which is to be seen by the court is if there is likelihood of confusion. So the moment the court is addressing, or the other side is taking the defendant is taking the court to the question of proof of confusion, you immediately have to point out that that's an incorrect question and the court should not be wasting its time on that question. Similarly, in copyright law, if you are for the defendant, so don't immediately just start denying infringement. Don't immediately start comparing the works. Of course, you have to do that. That's very important and that's a core part of your defense. But you also need to focus if that whether the plaintiff has been able to prove its copyright, right? And lastly, and most important thing, that you should follow all the legal news. You follow Bar and Bench, Live Law, Spicy IP. You should form your own opinions about everything, and you should not simply follow the opinion of the authors. You should write your views on social media, social network platforms also. So that's the end of my session. I'll take up questions now. But before we do that, I want someone to answer what are the three factors which are to be considered by the court while deciding the question of interim injunction.
So if a party seeks interim injunction from the court, then the party needs to establish a prima facie case in its favor. Right. Moreover, the party also has to show that the balance of convenience also falls in its favor and that irreparable injury would be caused if the injunction is not granted.
Perfect, perfect. Absolutely correct. I have one more question. I'll give you a situation. This is for all of you, especially those who are in third year. You're going to enter the field in a couple of months. So suppose you're a celebrity and you may be a basketball player or a cricket player or a movie star, and a professional photographer has clicked a photo of you at a public event or at an award show or while you're playing basketball, being a basketball player. Can you... This is your photo. You are the subject matter of that photo. Can you post that photo of yourself on social media platforms? Can anyone answer that? Yes. Yes, please.
Oh, yes, no, sir. You can't. Like, that's okay. The property of the photographer.
No, sir. Right. As per my opinion, anyone may post that photo because... whatever the once the photo has been sent or posted upon the site, that is his own intellectual things.
No, I'm that talking about, see the photo, see you need to understand the photo has been clicked by the photographer.
Yes.
But the photo,
he can post
yes.
It.
Yes, he can post it, you're saying, okay.
Yes.
No, I'm saying if you are the subject matter of the photograph, can you post it?
Yes, sir.
You're not the photographer, you are the celebrity.
Sir, I think the photographer have the intellectual property right to the photo because he is the one who has taken the photo.
All right. Would it not be protected under fair dealing? Anyone wants to make an attempt at that?
Sir, I think there is also a concept in copyright law that if I am the subject matter of the photograph and there has been a an understanding and a consideration has been paid to the photographer, then it is understood
assume there is no consideration paid. You have not taken the consent of the photographer.
Then, sir, it's absolutely viable. I can use it because under the fair dealing provision, I can do that. It's the same case wherein speakers go to the news channel and then they repost the news channel content to promote their talk.
Okay. Anyone else?
Yes, sir. So I think the celebrity have the right to, a celebrity can possibly sue with regard to, because I have seen a similar instance when the Neeraj Chopra has won the Olympic medal, that immediately several photographs has been popped up in several social media platforms, and they were, even same instance has been happened to PV Sindhu as well. So I relate with that, and I think.
Right. Okay, so I'll answer this for you. Now, recently, what has been seen mostly in US is that copyright infringement suits were being filed against celebrities, wherein celebrities were posting their own photos on their Instagram pages. And these photos were not clicked by the celebrities, they were clicked by professional photographers. Eventually, these disputes were settled, and there has been no such dispute in India yet. But in my opinion, this photograph, it's protected under section 14C of the Copyright Act, and the celebrity cannot post it, only the photographer can post it, because the only defense which a celebrity can take in this case is that the photo was for personal or private use. That's the only defense which may be available to a celebrity. Also, see, apart from this, there may be a conflict with celebrity rights, but that is a separate question. As far as copyright law is concerned, as far as the Copyright Act is concerned, there's only one defense, in my opinion, I may be wrong, which a celebrity can take, saying that the photo was for private and personal use. But the Indian courts have also interpreted that what is private and personal use, and posting of photographs on social media platforms for worldwide audience. The audience is not restricted, the photo is not for your family or your friends, it's for everyone, then that will not amount to private or personal use. So although we have not seen any such litigation in India, but it will be interesting if something comes up in the future. So with this, I end my session. I will share my presentation with Ms. Ruchita, and thank you all for being patient listeners, and all the best for your future. I'll take up the questions now.
Hello, sir. I'm Pradyumna Mishra. May I ask one question?
Yes, please.
Sir, once the suit has been filed as per convenient of the jurisdiction where the plaintiff resides, what would be the condition of execution of the, once decree has been passed, then which court having jurisdiction to execute that decree?
See, the court which passed the decree has jurisdiction to execute the decree. Anyways, that question will arise when the defendant does not comply with the injunction order. So if it's an interim injunction order, you can file a contempt. If it's a decree, then you can file for enforcement or execution, because the defendant has not complied. But the court which, to answer your question, the court which granted injunction has the authority and the jurisdiction to enforce its orders.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sir, you said that a professional photographer is protected, in your opinion, is protected by 14 clause C. Sir, but wouldn't unconsensual photographing then lead to stalking voyeurism in the case of paparazzis that we have seen?
See, when you're a celebrity, your life is open for the public, for the media. That will not amount to that. Basically, the celebrity need not consent to such photographs. Of course, if you're in your private space, then the media needs, or the paparazzi needs, your consent. But if you're a public figure, not just your photographs, but also your life is in public domain. You'll see with a lot of cases of celebrities where suits were filed, for example, in the case of Sushant Singh Rajput, or even in Jay Lalita's case, where the courts refused injunctions, saying that you're a celebrity. In fact, recently, if you would have followed this this news where Raj Kundra was arrested, and Raj Kundra filed petitions before courts seeking a media gag order, and the court clearly said that you chose this life to be a celebrity, so your life will be in public domain.
So therefore, following the same line of thought, can't a celebrity then plead that since I'm a public figure, I should be entitled under the fair provision to use that photograph?
See, that's what I said, that when the celebrity takes that defense, the celebrity needs to point out the exact provision under which it is claiming this defense. And there's only one such provision, which is personal or private use. But that again has been interpreted by the courts that posting of photos on your social media platform, if it's open to the public, there's a Bombay High Court judgment. I'll just give you the name of the judgment also. Just go through it. So the Bombay High Court clearly says that the fair dealing exception will not extend to such instances because it's open for the public. It's not for private or personal use. It's Telelink and others versus Polyester Limited.
So my doubt is regarding, it's a generic doubt due to this COVID, and like we see many papers, I mean, it is usual that a PDF of these newspapers comes into our mobile or WhatsApp groups very prevalently. So I have seen many news publications have been releasing their claim on that this is illegal, and I have even seen some legal experts saying this is illegal as per IT acts and even copyright as well. So I was just trying to see, first of all, that is there any settled precedent that this has been declared as illegal? And second question is,
First make the first question clear, which instances you're talking about?
If a newspaper, consider a very famous newspaper's PDF, daily newspaper,
right,
has come.
Yes, yes. There's a judgment of Delhi High Court. I think it was in the case of Dainik Bhaskar versus Telegram, where the court said that these newspapers, the PDF of these newspapers cannot be circulated online, be it on WhatsApp, Telegram, or any cloud storage platform. This is illegal. This amounts to copyright infringement. I think that answers your first question.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah.
So second question comes that what if I as a student, like I committed the same thing, like I have shared, and it has been shared multiply through different groups, and like, so how will be a liability be taken on all those, considering the.
See, ignorance of law is not a defense. You already know if you've done it by mistake, the best thing is to offer an apology and settle the matter, because even if you've done it by mistake, you'll still be liable for copyright infringement if you have shared anything.
Yes, sir. But I was just trying to see what would be the available defense if anything can be availed or.
No, if you've shared infringing content, then what defense can you possibly claim? You know that the content is infringing and you are not supposed to share it. Now, even if you've shared it, then I don't think that this will be covered under the fair dealing exception.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for some very important inputs there. I think some very critical discussions regarding as to how the litigation actually falls out in the court of law. So that was very interesting. A friendly reminder to my third year colleagues that we need to brush up upon our procedural laws as well. Without taking much of the time now and, you know, to go towards the last session, the learnings of the past three sessions as to what is the key takeaway. For us, it's very important to analyze as to what are the opportunities that lie ahead in this field of law. And I don't think that we could have had a better mentor than Ms. Bitika Sharma, who's a senior partner with Singh & Singh, to guide us through this. Just a small background into our next speaker. Ma'am has been associated with Singh & Singh for the past 17 years now. She has been a DU loyalist. Ma'am did her graduation from Maitri College and then went on to take her law from Faculty of Law, University of Delhi. Be it trademark litigation, patent litigation, ma'am has had the opportunity to work with some of the biggest clients, PepsiCo, Novartis, and Cadila. Another important part of experience of ma'am's profile so far has been to advise clients on to what is something I think fairly new to a lot of us, like advising on patent portfolios and, you know, standard essential patents and the freedom to operate when it comes to pharma industry. So ma'am has worked on all of those domains. So I'll now hand over the session to ma'am to guide us through the session ahead. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much for a wonderful introduction.
And I am obliged and I feel very, very pleased to be a part of this workshop because Delhi University and Faculty of Law has been my alma mater, and I have very, very fond memories of the college. So, and I'm very, very touched to be here. The session which I chose is Career in IP. And I have a small PPT which Vikram will share with you. Vikram, you can share it. I will not be reading each and every aspect of the PPT. It will be circulated. You can have it and you can go through it. My endeavor would be to basically apprise you of my experience and give you some guidance on how and why you should choose IP as your career. As I see, there are a fair number of people who are participants in this workshop. So I do see that you people must be very interested in intellectual property laws. It is, of course, one of the most popular field of law, which nowadays all the aspiring lawyers are choosing. The first question which would come into your mind is whether specialization is necessary. Yes, I would say it is a good thing to choose a particular a niche subject for your career. To start on, yes, there are people who say that you should try each and everything and then specialize. But my experience has been different. I started my career as a full-time intern during my entire final year. I used to do my classes and half day I used to do internship at Singh Singh. And I started with IP and I only did IP. But then after doing IP, I realized that IP is not all about only trademarks and copyrights and patents. There are so much intertwined angles to IP that you would touch each and every aspect of law. You would touch your CPC, of course. You would touch your Evidence Act, of course. You would touch criminal laws as well. Your CRPC provisions, everything is intertwined. The procedure is very vast. It's a very, very vast field. It is wrong to suggest that it only includes trademarks and copyrights and patents. No, it's not like that. So Vikram, you can just scroll down the slide. So when you get up in the morning, you are surrounded by intellectual property. How and why? When you wake up, first reaction nowadays, you pick up your phone. When you pick up your phone, this phone has immense amount of intellectual property into it. This has a design, the aesthetic look, which is the design. Okay, that has a design aspect to it. Then you have patented technologies into it. Then you have various apps which are copyrighted work, definitely, right? Then why apps are copyrighted work? Because in India, a computer software is not patented. The protection comes under copyright laws as algorithms, as a soft source code protection. You can file a patent only if it is dependent on the hardware. Now, then you move ahead, you go to Starbucks. Obviously, that logo is a trademark. So here comes your trademark to identify the source. Then you listen to music. Now, music, as Love suggested, there are a lot of copyrighted work, underlying work, which are related to music. Then you have various apps which are running around and providing music to you, right? So how does this entire system work? There are advertisements which you will hear. People are saying, when advertisement is there, if you try to say, no, my product is better and yours is bad, the disparagement laws come into play. They find their feet in trademark law, for sure, but then it's a tort also. So everything is so intertwined and interconnected. So here, what I was saying, there are conventional IP, trademark, copyright, patent, design, geographical indications you would study, for sure. But there are some non-conventional IPs as well, which you would come across if you try and if you enter into this field. Now, there are sports and IP law, which includes your brand endorsements, right? So now Virat Kohli is, you know, doing an ad exclusively for Pepsi. Obviously, he cannot advertise for Coke because then there will be brand endorsement contracts which would take place. Then he would be the face of that particular brand. So, you know, if his face is used to publicize or disparage some other brand, then obviously your disparagement laws will come into play. Your Copyright Act comes into play. Then media and entertainment is there. Definitely, if you are a celebrity, your privacy laws are also there, right? You cannot, even if you are a celebrity, I cannot encroach your privacy, right? So if that is there, you need to enforce your privacy laws. If you are a celebrity, you have a publicity law as well, which is not yet recognized in India, but the matters have been argued on this. Like Love suggested, there was this Sushant Singh Rajput case, in which there was a series which was made, and a movie, I guess, was made. And father of Mr. Sushant Singh Rajput agitated that, you know, he's my son, he has his own right, he's a public personality. So he's a publicity right, he has a publicity right, and I'm the owner because I'm his father. So that right has devolved on me. But the court said that, no, with his death, his publicity right has gone with him. Which I disagree personally, because what we do in our entire life is we create our name. Okay, when we go from this earth, what remains is our name. If we cannot protect that, then obviously, you know, I don't agree with this judgment. But then the matter is sub judice. Then you have your data protection laws. Oh my God, so many things are being said on Pegasus, on this. Recently, this Bullyby app, you know, people are picking up somebody's faces, putting somewhere else. Data protection is a very, very important field of law, which will take a lot of boom in recent years. Why? Because of all this technology, we are sitting and we are able to look into others' life through social media profiles or through various websites, and also not only of individuals but also the data of various companies and all, right? So all this has to be protected at some point of time. There are confidential data with the companies which have to be protected. There are agreements which have to be protected. So everything can't just, you know, fall in public domain. There have to be laws in place. Recently, if you would have stated data, the Personal Data Protection Bill was introduced in 2019. Then it was recommended to a standing committee. That report has recently come in December. So government is working on it. So this is another area which will expand in coming years. You must keep a tab on it. Then obviously IT and cyber laws, definitely with so much of cyber crime going ahead. That is also something which will evolve in coming years. The laws are being laid. It's a dynamic field. You know, you should, as an aspirant, you should always look for a career option which is growing, which has scope of growth, right? In trademark, for instance, when I opted as my career, trademark was still developing. Now, a lot of aspects of trademark law has been settled, right? But patent has not been settled yet. We are in the midway. So you should always choose for fields which are growing. You have a lot of scope to, you know, then argue, then, you know, let the law be laid, help the courts to lay the correct law. These are the areas you must pick. Disparagement, as I suggested, then PPVFR, which is protection of plant varieties and farmers, right? This is, I don't think so many of the firms are dealing with this law. Only one or two firms have a monopoly on this. So this is something which is definitely going to grow with a lot of inventions being taking place in biotechnology, in the seed varieties. So this is something which is very important. Then Biodiversity Act, when we talk about biotechnology, people, if you are a science if you have a science background and you are doing law the way I did, then you do have a lot of scope in PPBFR, biodiversity and patent act. In the IP new millennium, the areas which will grow are definitely pharmaceutical patents, which we have seen in COVID era. There were some drugs which were available readily because they were off patent. There were few drugs which were not readily available because they were in the patent regime. Only the innovators were supposed to manufacture it. They were supposed to be only imported. So the way a society moves, the law develops with it. So pharmaceutical patents is something which wherein a lot of work is going on. Because earlier we only had international companies like Pfizer, Merck and Roche only doing the innovation. Now we have Indian companies like Zydus, Cadila who have come up with their own invented molecule, Saroglitazar. So which is very important. So our country is moving towards innovation, right? So moving with that flow will definitely give a boom to your career. Then standard essential patents, definitely. Now, if you pick up any gadget, a phone or iPad or even your smart TV, you have your 3G, 4G technologies. And any smartphone cannot work without these technologies. And these are essential patents. Companies like Ericsson and Qualcomm or LG is there, Mitsubishi is there. They come up with these kind of technologies and they apply for a standard, they become a standard essential patents. Standard, as it the name says, standard is they have a criteria and they take a standard, notification from authorities. Then it is essential. It has to be there. Like if I pick up a phone, I know it has to have 4G compliance. So, but the 4G patent is of Ericsson. So definitely even my phone is of Apple, but then it is using a technology of Ericsson. So what will happen? Apple has to take a license from Apple, right? So if Apple, from Ericsson, sorry. So if Ericsson has a portfolio of, for instance, 300 patents on 2G and 3G technologies, they have to be licensed to Apple. And Ericsson in that ways earn a huge, huge revenue, not by selling any product or tangible asset, only by selling the technology, which is your standard essential patent, right? So when we talk about IP, it's huge, huge money. Then plant varieties, I've just suggested. Trade secrets, definitely you would know. When you have a patent, you do an invention and you have a patent on it, it has a term, 20 years. After 20 years, it falls into public domain. Everybody can use it. But if you think that nobody will be able to crack your technology by reverse engineering, you have a good scope of keeping it as a trade secret because it doesn't have any term attached to it. Like it's like the recipe of Coca-Cola. It's a trade secret. So there are few other technologies which are kept as trade secrets. Then definitely when you talk about trade secrets, your laws of data protection come into play, right? So I'm just trying to say that how everything is so intertwined. So whenever you are choosing your career, don't go with an option, with a mindset that, okay, you will be doing trademarks. Okay, you'll be doing patents. No. When you get involved into this, you have to have knowledge of all these ancillary field of laws as well. Then IP and competition law. IP and competition law, what is IP? What is patent? It's basically a monopoly which you get, which is like you are keeping rest away and you are having a monopoly over it. And what is competition law? Competition law says they discourage monopoly, right? Any entity cannot have a monopoly or a monopolistic trade licenses. They keep a watch on the market. So these are the two sides of a single coin, but they go side by side, right? So whenever there are licensing and agreements which are taking place of any party to, you know, give licenses to of their technology to various parties, CCI, Competition Commission, always have an eye over them. Like, for instance, I gave an example of Ericsson. Now, a CCI investigation is pending against Ericsson. So, basically, if you have an essential patent, you are giving licenses to everybody and everybody has to take a license from you. So, CCI is investigating whether you are actually giving the license on a reasonable term or not. Then, complex fair use defenses, definitely Love has touched upon these, but which are also very important, because it could be a very simple thing, like you have an account on Spotify and you create your own playlist and you put it on Spotify, your account of Spotify. Now, Spotify has applied for a statutory license, for instance, just before the launch, we did that case. They applied for a statutory license against the portfolio or the repertoire of Saregama. That's still pending, but Saregama filed a suit against Spotify. So we said we did apply for statutory licensing and we are willing to pay. And any work which is being posted on our app is being posted by the labels or by the people who have created their account. So we have not done anything. But then it's a very, very complex issue, whether we can take that as a fair use or not, because we are providing a platform where people can pick up somebody's work and post it, right? Eventually that got settled. Then biosimilars, definitely again, a very complex and a niche field of IP, where we talk about biological drugs, right? Which are like long, long peptide chains. One innovator has it, like trastuzumab is a drug of Roche, but now Reliance or Cadila has come up with a long peptide chain which is similar to the drug molecule which trastuzumab has created. Now these are similar because these are very, very, very long chains, so these can't be identical. So whether these kind of things are protected or not, yes, they are protected under biosimilar guidelines, right? Then data exclusivity. This law is not there in India, but then if you get into this profession, you will listen to this term repeatedly. It is like if a drug is protected, when you file a patent for a drug, I'm a patentee, I need to take drug approval from drug authorities and I need to do my clinical trials. When I do my clinical trials, a lot of years are passed. Once I get my clinical trial approval done, a license, by then, within the 20 years of monopoly, I have already lost maybe 10 to 15 years. So to compensate that, I get an additional 5 years monopoly. That is there in US, in other countries worldwide, but it is not there in India yet. But maybe we will get this soon. Then data protection, I have already touched upon. Next slide, please. So now when we talk about IP, the possible related jobs, which you can look at it, law firms and private practice for sure. I would try to tell you here, don't take a jump, move slowly. You know, when we talk about IP, don't think that you have to straight away go and join Anand or Singh and Singh. Try, good internships are a must. Keep a watch on good internships. Do long-term internships, do IP practice internship even on smaller firms. Even if there is a small practitioner doing IP laws, you can do internships over there. You will learn a lot over there. Just don't try and say, no, I want to do IP, and don't be discouraged if you don't get through big firms. Start from a low level. Then even if you are getting internships in competition law firms, that is also good enough, because you will be definitely dealing with a lot of IP, as I explained on the overlap between competition law and patent law. Then obviously audits and valuations is one of the important aspects which is related to IP laws, because even if you are doing joining any corporate law firm and doing your due diligence work, audits and valuation of IP as intangible asset plays a very, very important role. Because if there is a company is manufacturing something, it is not only making money through the sales of that particular product. But when you sell that product under a brand, you create a brand equity, you create a goodwill, which is in millions and millions of dollars, and which you license it to your subsidiaries or to other companies, and you make a lot of money out of it. So definitely these are very important aspects when it comes to audits and valuation field, as well as your taxation field. Then corporate laws, I just suggested, apart from audit and valuation, in corporate law, when you are making any contract, apart from that contract being an intellectual property per se of your company, if it is confidential, it's a document created, then you also need to understand, when you are making any agreement, that what is getting transferred. If an IP is getting transferred, or an IP is getting licensed, or who will remain the owner, you need, really need to apply your mind to that as well. Investigation and enforcement agent advisory, this is also an upcoming field wherein people have opened their investigation agencies. They investigate into counterfeits. They report those counterfeits either to the proprietors or to the law firms, and aid in enforcement of against those counterfeits, like helping in search and seizures, providing manpower. This is also another industry which is developed. Then of course media, fashion and sports, which I suggested that a lot of IP is involved in this industry as well. Next slide, please. I have touched upon SCP portfolios, given the example of Ericsson, patented drugs versus generics drugs. Also, I have given an example of how pharmaceutical industries do R&D and then they develop their patent portfolios. Brand franchising, definitely, if you have a brand like Cafe Coffee Day, a lot of franchises are open. Again, a lot of work on corporate side takes place when you are doing your franchise agreements. A lot of work on your tax side take place. But then brand franchising and licensing is a very lucrative field where you help and you do brand valuation, and then you shortlist and you know that, this is the royalty or this is the license fee which the proprietor will definitely be entitled to. Industrial design licensing, definitely, if you have an industrial design, you license it to other parties and you earn from it. Then copyrights and royalties earn, definitely. Whatever is the work, be it musical work or a cinematographic work, or even source code copyrights, when you license it, you need to have earn royalties. So these agreementation and this kind of work is also growing day by day. Okay, future of IP, definitely India is going to be a hub of innovation. As I said, that India has come up with, for example, has come up with their first patented molecule. That is a patent thing. Then with a lot of move or a boom from the government, Atmanirbhar and Make in India kind of programs, government is pushing the startups also that, you should do your own innovation. With any small entity coming up with their own innovation or doing their own startup, for example, Zomato is there or Swiggy is there, right? You develop a chain, you get, you develop your own app, which is a copyrighted protected app. A huge amount of IP is created. The moment you have a startup, immense amount of IP is created, but how to streamline it, how to move in a correct position is something which the government is actually trying to make people aware and pushing, that India has to come up at this global level of standards for IP. No longer the court, neither the courts nor the government appreciates violations in IP, right? Then registrations, the government is doing a lot of work that lesser time should take place in grant of patents and trademark registrations. Increasing in domestic filing, they are giving huge subsidized rates to startups, for example. Then IP licensing, they are encouraging, should take place. Then IP litigation, definitely is increasing, is will increase. This is something which will never go out of market. When the more the damages are granted by the courts, the more people will be inclined to protect their IP. If in my experience, you know, when I started my career back in 2003, when I was an intern, I had only, you know, there were only parties which were reluctant to get their trademark filed. They thought, ki, oh my God, 300 rupees fees dena padega. So, you know, they didn't understand that how important it is to create your own IP portfolio. But now, even if there's a small entrepreneur who would have started their business like a small bakery at their place, they would know that, you know, okay, the name of my bakery has to be registered. I have to create my own app. So I have, you know, people are getting aware, which is a good move. Then modern facilities, definitely video conferencing and transcription. These are something which are even the government is promoting the Digital India campaign, and even the courts are promoting now. So next slide. This you can just go through. I will not deal with all this. I have just touched upon. Vikram, you can go ahead. National IPR policy, definitely in 2016 it came, which shows how government is serious towards IP. If government is getting serious, definitely there is a positive move towards it. So definitely it becomes a very feasible option for law aspirants to choose it as a career. Next slide, please. Overall trends in IP now. People who are in Delhi, they are very lucky because most of the IP cases take place in Delhi. After Delhi, I would say in my experience, Chennai, there's a lot of IP filing which takes place in Chennai. The cases take place in Chennai. Then Mumbai being a corporate hub, and since your Bollywood is there, so a lot of copyright work takes place in Mumbai. So these are metropolitan cities where there's a lot of work which is taking place in IP field. But recently I've come across that even cities like Hyderabad and Bangalore, apart from that, even cities like Chandigarh, they have picked up a lot of IP work. So people who are not from Delhi should not be disheartened, because other cities have really, really picked up on IP work as well. So since the original sites are there in Delhi, Chennai, Mumbai and Kolkata High Court, people straight away file in High Court. But in other areas, you have to file in District Court. But in my experience, District Courts are doing a very, very good job when it comes to IP, because everybody is IP savvy now. District judges, they also take up with the matters of with equal importance and diligence as the High Court takes them. Then remedies, definitely you have under your CPC, injunction is there, search and seizure are there, which my colleagues have already discussed. Filings have increased in Delhi High Court and Chennai and Mumbai High Court for sure. Next slide, please. With the coming of commercial court, there is an increase in IP litigation because there are strict guidelines. So we are hoping to have the trial is faster, the injunction hearings are faster, but definitely we need to have more of final judgments. Okay, legislative enforcement climate. I have touched upon how government and everybody's, see, there is no doubt that IP is growing, but my topic is career in IP. I want to give you insight that how you can make career in IP more fruitful. You know, if you are going to do a civil practice, doing your own practice instantly is easy. But if you are doing your IP practice, I would suggest that first you do a little bit of training, either through internship in IP firms or IP solo practitioners, and then you move on to your own individual practice, right? Because the reason why I'm saying, because IP or IP portfolios are generally of big companies or mid-level companies. Any individual having an IP, that scenario is very, very, what I would say, rare, right? So any company or a mid-level company or a firm having a good turnover will not hand over your portfolio if you are a single practitioner who is just a pass out from a law college, right? So, which is a very practical thing. So, you need to get associated with some firm or with a practitioner or have an experience, and then you can go and, you know, market yourself that, yes, I'm an IP practitioner, I'm a solo practitioner now, but I have an experience of 3 years or 4 years, which I think is fair enough. So leading cases in IPR field, my colleagues have really dealt with a lot of cases. But if you even are going for an interview, you need to know few cases which any law firm would ask you about. If you want, Novartis is one of the case, Novartis versus Union of India. Then Roche Cipla is, Novartis is definitely related to patents, section 3D. I'm sure you would have in your course material also. But then Roche versus Cipla is also an important case, which is a post-trial and a final judgment case, which deals with pharmaceuticals, which also revolves on 3D a bit, but then it also had the fastest trial in this case, and very important, followed in various patent cases. Toyota is a price judgment is on well-known trademark. When we talk about well-known trademark, everybody talks about Whirlpool judgment and all those judgments. Now this is an exception to those judgments. Here, the trademark priors of Toyota was not recognized, saying that you don't have a well-known status in India for the mark priors when you instituted the suit, right? So it's the reverse. You should be aware of these cases. Shreya Singhal, definitely my colleague dealt with it. It's on WhatsApp policies. Then Genentech versus drug controller. You guys must read this judgment. This is on biosimilars. But it deals with Roche's endeavor to try to monopolize a drug wherein the patent had lapsed. There was no trademark. There was no copyright attached to it. But then still they said that you have not done adequate clinical trials. Hence, you cannot market this drug. But this is the patentee, the plaintiff lost in this case. But if you read this judgment, you will know and you will understand and you will appreciate the point which I am trying to say, that IP is not only about trademark and patent and copyright laws per se. You really, really need to dig in deep when you are into practice. Saregama versus Spotify, I just generally mentioned that. Okay, this is also one of the case, Aishar versus Krishna Mehta. This is a very interesting case wherein we try to protect some of the motives which are created by Good Earth, taking examples from historical monuments or nature. So if you see the plaintiff's artwork here was a falcon. There's a falcon sitting on that Badshah's hand. And similar falcon design was put on defendant's artwork on a cushion cover. Now, I had this Serai design, which is a Jali design, which was taken from Himayu Tom's journey. So they said, no, it is Himayu Tom's only. Everybody can use it. I have used it on a cushion, not on a cup. So, but then the court said, no, even if inspiration has been taken from somewhere else, but you have applied your mind and you have, nobody would have thought to pick up that Jali and put it on a cup or a cushion cover. There is goodwill attached to it, and there is invention, some design aspect to it. So it was protected. A little dicey kind of a judgment. People would appreciate it also. People would differ also. But then one thing with this I want to add. In IP, you will get judgment on both the sides definitely. Like there was a person who asked a question on whether, you know, if you have a device mark and you have a word mark, which one would weigh better. You will have judgments both ways. Take it from me. On every aspect of IP, even if it is like, you know, acronym, if you talk about device mark, if you talk about generic drugs, if you talk about copyrighted artwork in copyrighted work in a source code, you will get judgments on both the sides. So only you should know where to look, right? And how to look and how to present your case in a way which is beneficial to your client. So IP is a very, very vast field, and you really need to follow all the judgments. Now it's very easy with, you know, bar and bench and live law. You should subscribe to it, spicy IP, and then, you know, you are aware of what is happening. But very important thing, don't go by the headings or the taglines which come in bar and bench and in all these platforms. They are really misleading. If there is a tagline, please open the judgment, please open the order and read it. You will realize that the tagline said something else, but in effect, the judgment said something else. So if you are serious in this profession, just don't go by those headlines, headnotes. So if you choose IP, a very, very important incentive, you should know. If you are in IP, you get to, and you are in a firm, you get to go to various international conferences, because it is very, very important for IP firm to attend those conferences, because IP is a global kind of a field. So people would have heard about INTA. Every year that conference takes place, people go and meet, you discuss laws of various lands, and then you know that, okay, you have this kind of a law, we also have this kind of a law. Okay, no, you have, okay, 3D is something which is there in India, which is not there in there in US. So you would appreciate your laws land as of the land as well, and as well as what is happening in other countries. So the vision broadens. APA is APAA, Asian Patent Attorney Association. It is a patent specific conference which takes place. Then AIPPI, International Association for Protection of Intellectual Property. It's a very good conference. People can become member of these organizations. You all can also get members of these organizations. Mind you, you can check on the website. You can become member. You get notifications. It really would help you to enhance your vision and your knowledge into this field. Then International Federation of Intellectual Property Association, IPA. So these are some of the conferences and organizations. You must take note of it and do a little bit of Google. With a very, very nominal fee, for instance, of AIPPI, you can become a member, and it's very informative to be part of these conferences. With conclusionary remarks, I would say IP is the most important and valuable asset for software and knowledge intensive companies. Due to lack of knowledge, India lags behind in leveraging IP. Need of growth of illicit trade, yes, this is there. When I say that, you know, till now we have come up with only one patented drug, people still are reluctant to invest and create their own intellectual property by way of registrations or enforcing. Even today, I know the companies which are Indian companies who would spend, millions over registration of a trademark, but they will not file a suit because 2 lakhs of court fee is going to be paid before Delhi High Court, and they would be investing into, litigation. Now, that's the wrong approach. What if you are not enforcing, there's no point of having a registration. So you really need to have that kind of persuasive power to tell your clients that how enforcement is equally important as registration is. Need of the hour, human resource, trick enforcement, definitely. Human resource, when we talk about our IP offices, we really need to have good HR resources in our IP offices to remove the backlogs. That goes for our courts as well. And then definitely strict enforcement is required by our courts as well as by the owners. They should come up and, you know, file cases. Role of universities and academic institutions is of great responsibility. Definitely making people aware is very, very important. With this era of internet, I think things are much easier now. People get to know about various things. They know what is happening in the society, unlike our times where or only the newspaper was the source and it never used to cover each and everything. But universities and academic institutions really have to come up and be active, you know, or they can try and be participants in something which is a question of law. Like, for instance, Love mentioned that Lahiri matter is there in Supreme Court on statutory licensing, whether it would cover your apps like Spotify and these kind of broadcasters also or not. You should take notes, try and follow it, and you know, try and make discussions on various platforms so that people know what are the views of students or lecturers, what are the masses which are, you know, you should, jaise kehte hai na, nabs pakadna janta ki, wo universities and academic institutions can really help on that. R&D expenditure needs to increase, definitely, because that Indian lala mentality of, you know, keeping the money in the safe is something which never helps. You should do your R&D, create IP, and as I have said, there are companies who are only running by licensing their IPs. They don't have any product to sell, right? So that is a mindset which has to be, you know, grilled in Indian mentality. In the next decade, India needs to focus on innovation in order to become more competitive in protectionist regime, definitely. And we as lawyers, and if we try to are wanting to become an IP lawyer, we have a lot of responsibility to see that the law is developed in a good way, in a way which promotes innovation and doesn't kill it. That's very important. Now I would take question and answers.
Oh, in the meanwhile, I think some very critical inputs by you, ma'am. I think the one that particularly struck me was that due to COVID, like everybody's internship and like professional plans are a little skewed, but the realization that these laws don't need to be seen in silos. So it's not like that if you're talking about IPR, we just focus upon the main legislations, you know, the interaction as to how IPR interacts with competition or even on the corporate side. I think that's very encouraging, because if somebody is not finding the right opportunity in IPR at the moment, it's always best to go to the next best option that's available.
Correct.
So I think it's a very important.
Correct. That's what I meant to say, that, you know, you need to take baby steps. You should never feel discouraged that, you know, I want to do IP, but I haven't gotten through any big firm. But then you need to take baby steps. Even if you are doing you are working with a civil lawyer in Tisazari and he is doing a small trademark matter, start from there. Don't be discouraged. And eventually you'll end up there.
Very useful, very structured use of time that is there. I guess Om has a question. So Om, if you could unmute yourself and go ahead with your question.
Good afternoon, Bitika ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, I want to know that do we have to have the knowledge of IP prosecution before going into IP litigation?
Not necessary, but it is always helpful, right? I started my practice of my career from IP prosecution, trademark prosecution, IP prosecution, and then developed into litigation. It helped me. Okay, so, but then it is necessary. That is not the case, because when you are doing your litigation, there are few aspects which you would come across, and gradually you can learn prosecution also. But if you have that base, you pick up very fast.
And ma'am, what are the skills the law firms look in to the candidates?
When my partners interview, we always look for the first of all interest in IP. And how would you gauge the interest in IP? By knowing that you are aware of what is happening in IP. So knowing recent case laws, I'm not saying each and every case law, but then at least Supreme Court level case law is something which we, because everybody is getting inputs on your phone now, it's very easy. Earlier we never used to ask, ki kya padha aapne, recent judgment kya hai, but now we do know that people are getting information through phone. So we expect ki aapko itna to pata hai ki haan, Supreme Court mein abhi latest case kya hai. So itna knowledge is required, and you should read a lot. Read a lot.
Okay, ma'am. Thanks, ma'am.
Avantika, you can go ahead now.
Ma'am, what value will the patent agent certification add to the profile of a three-year law graduate who has done, like, who has majored in sciences?
It will really take you to a very, very high level, because if you are a qualified patent agent, along with being a qualified lawyer, definitely you are the cream which law firms look for.
So is it more on the technological side, like conducting patent landscape searches or white space analysis, or more on the litigation side?
Both. On a litigation side, if you are a qualified patent agent, then definitely when we are doing a litigation, and if you also have the knowledge of prosecution very well, then you can dig in the loopholes very well, right? So that helps in litigation. But if you're not doing litigation and you're doing only valuation and, for instance, searches or patentability analysis, then definitely you are required, you are helpful for a prosecution firm. But then this combination is a deadly combination for sure.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ananjay Pratap Singh.
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, I have an interest in IPR and I'm trying to get internships, but I'm not able to get any good internship. So, should I join any internship in any field that I can get, or should I specifically wait for IPR? Because I want to pursue a career in IPR.
See, that's what I said. If you are getting a good internship, very well, but don't sit and wait. You should join whosoever you are getting to, because you will learn something, right? And it's not only that you are learning from the internship from that very organization where you have joined. When you do internship, unlike this COVID era, when if you get to go to court, or if you get to go to meet other people, other lawyers, that itself gives you a lot of insight. So don't just sit and wait. Try for it, but then you should do whatever is coming your way.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ijaz?
Yes, ma'am. So my doubt is regarding my interest. I have a keen interest with niche areas of mergers and acquisition, private equity and venture capital. And equally, I have an interest with regards to IP matters. So, and I recently came across it is a quite earlier case of Volkswagen and BMW IP case, and it was how it affected mergers and acquisition. So I was just trying to see your insights on how it can be, considering the Indian situation right now, how we can brush up our skills and with regard to connecting these both areas of IP and M&A.
See, when we talk about M&A, definitely IP is a complete chapter in M&A. Whenever you are doing a merger, IP is a complete chapter. You have to deal with it as, you know, give it that importance. When you talk about, you spoke about this case, you know, in Indian scenario, initially, brands were only valued. Only the trademark was valued in an M&A. Or kehte the ki theek hai, iska kya value hai, and this is done. But now, with increase in the structure of a company, then you have your subsidiaries, then you have your associate sister concerns. Everybody is using, for instance, the brand name Tata this, Tata that. So, that family tree becomes, the bigger the family tree is, the more is value added to it, right? Because each and every company is an individual and they have their own goodwill also attached to it. So it's not easy to say that, you know, yes, for M&A it would be important or it would not be important. Definitely it is on a case to case basis. But then having an insight and knowledge of IP law when you are doing an M&A is very, very important. Otherwise you will lose on a good amount of, you know, money transaction this way or that way.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
All right. So I think we are done.
Right. Thank you so much, ma'am. Very important insights. Now, if I would request Ruchita, ma'am, to proceed with a vote of thanks for our speakers in this session.
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much, Arushi. So first of all, you know, today on behalf of the Placement Assistance Council Campus Law Center, first of all, I would like to express my deepest delight regarding this event. It has been really wonderful to listen to the industry experts, regarding these practical aspects of very important trademark and copyright laws. So thank you very much. And of course, this event would not have been possible without the help of a number of people. So first of all, I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to Singh and Singh Law Firm for collaborating with us and agreeing to organize this insightful workshop. My special thanks to all the eminent speakers for sparing their valuable time and interacting with our students. Next, I would like to thank, of course, our very dear professor in charge, Professor Dr. Alka Chawla ma'am, for being with us throughout the conception and organization of this event. And without her help, her personal interest in the workshop, you know, this huge success of, you know, of this workshop was definitely not possible. The Campus Law Center office is to be equally thanked for the event to happen. And I also extend my deepest gratitude to all my senior faculties and colleagues who were a part of the event and who spared their valuable time and showed their faith upon us. I would next like to thank all the members of Singh and Singh Law Firm who have been extremely cooperative and actively involved to ensure that the program flows flawlessly. So, you know, starting from technical assistance to the background work to coordination, I really would like to thank all the people who were involved in it. And of course, I would like to thank all the participants for your enthusiasm, for being present for the event. Without you, of course, the event would not have been possible. And your enthusiasm, your interest over the subject is really a motivation for us to conduct such events in the future again. And last but not the least, of course, I would like to thank my team, that is Team PAC, we call it in short, the Placement Assistance Council Campus Law Center. So it is a student-run body, and all the students, they volunteer for the work. So thank you very much, team. Your, you know, the energy that you have channeled for this workshop to happen is really commendable. So thank you very much. And of course, once again, before ending the program, calling it a day for today, thanks everyone who have been involved directly or indirectly with this workshop. Thank you, all of you, to be here.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Goodbye.